It's Wednesday. It's Collider Live. I can feel the energy. I can feel the magic. This is going to be a special show today. I don't know why. I have no idea why. And one of those reasons it could be is because joining us today is it's my buddy, Marc Ellis. Hello, Marc Ellis. How are you?
Good to be back with everybody. Still nice high from the weekend. What a weekend it was. I'm sure you guys have talked about it.
We have. But it was good, man. We haven't heard your point of view on it. I mean, crushing it at the comedy show and then crushing it at the live event.
Thank you very much. I do have a response to issue to a member of the crew here who happens to be over there.
Uh-oh.
Is it Cobbster tweeted a picture
of a
Bud Light
that
he had bought for me at the bar after the show, after the Schmoedown, and I didn't drink it. And there's a lot of controversy. It's like, why is Ellis not drinking Bud Light?
I did see that, and we got updates every like 30 minutes that the beer was still on the table, right?
My response, official response.
Can I guess? You don't drink before shows.
No, this is after I don't drink before shows.
Right.
This is after the show, after the Schmoedown.
Yeah, what happened?
You don't like Bud Light anymore?
He brought me a warm Bud Light.
Oh, he brought
it
warm.
It was a warm Bud Light.
You kept getting warm beers throughout the weekend.
Then I felt bad because Megan brought us a warm Stella. Because I was finally done with the show. Most people were drinking before the Schmoedown or during the Schmoedown, and I like drinking before I go on stage. So after we're finally done with this huge marathon event, I'm like, okay, before the Q&A, and go grab a beer, and I text Megan. I'm like, is there any way I can get a couple of beers? And she brings back
wasn't that warm though.
It's not just the warm stuff.
Megan is the stage manager of the Schmoedown.
Oh. Yes.
She's an essential part of the mission.
Yes.
I've never seen anybody who run an event.
So I know her.
Yeah, you've met her. She was at the awards.
She's the very lovely blonde girl who's always right where you need her when you need her.
She was backstage at the awards the whole time standing there. She was awesome.
She's the best.
Yeah.
She's
great.
She's doing a lot of stuff.
The one lap she had is when she allowed Roxy to smoke pot. Coming back, So she brings me like this. She brings me this Stella, and it's just so not cold. You know, it was just like fresh out of the thing.
Yeah.
It's not her fault. That's all they had up front.
No, she was just doing it. Yeah, what do you
But it's this thing about New York in general that I noticed.
Uh-oh, what are you going to do? Kalinowski here?
They don't put as much of a premium on having the beer cold as we do out here.
I think that's not true at all.
That's not, I'm telling you, I've been multiple times, they don't care about the chill factor like we do here in Los Angeles.
Let me put.
You need to express the chill factor right now.
Let me back up Marc on this one. It was so cold the whole time that even if the beer was like lukewarm and I was holding it outside, I would have been like, this beer's freezing.
Was it cold? Considering what's happening right now in the Midwest?
Considering where we come from.
True. If you go to different pockets.
When
I got back on whatever the hell it was, Sunday, it was like 70.
Right.
65, 70. As opposed to, I think, maybe 25 or 30 in New York. But in Chicago right now, what did you say it was?
Chicago's negative 30 something. I mean, with the wind chill and everything, it's like negative 30 something. Minneapolis right now is like negative 50 something.
People are staying in their houses. They're telling me from the freeze.
We used to have these in Boston when it would get below negative 7.
Yeah.
We'd have to have these cold days because you can't go to school.
Yeah.
Did you guys see, not to make it political, and it's not about that, but just one of the most amazing tweets of the year, Donald Trump tweeted that he misses global warming.
And he misspelled it and spelled it global whamming.
Yeah, the thing that appalls me the most about that is that he literally stole a Larry the Cable Guy joke. Because that's a Larry the Cable Guy joke. Larry the Cable Guy playing to an audience anyway, and he's like, global warming, that's negative 4 in D.C. And that's like on especially 2 years ago. So now it's like, if you're stealing shit from Larry the Cable Guy as a presidential tweet, that's probably not the best look.
But
I was going to fly into Chicago next weekend to look at a venue.
Right.
And I think I might.
You wait. Well, that was the thing. Look, when we put the tickets on sale in the first place, it was a question in January: do we go to New York? Do we go to Florida? Do we go to Chicago?
Florida.
For what?
January.
I mean, that was. But the question is, where was the audience, right? And the two biggest.
Sure.
On side of the pole.
You wanted to go to New York.
But it was
we all wanted to go to New York.
Just beat out Chicago by a little bit. I mean, just a little. Chicago was big. And imagine if Chicago would have won out and we were there in January.
But Chicago, too, for the event that is going to be there is the smarter thing.
It's much smarter thing.
And April in Chicago, it'll either be cold, it'll rain, or it'll be beautiful.
Right.
That's like that Midwest, East Coast weather.
And we'll be there for like 5 days because of the celebration.
Can I go?
You can come.
Maybe.
Can come.
Yeah.
That's what I'm looking for.
Oh.
Yeah.
Thank you.
She can come as part of my crew.
Thank you.
These things that I have in my hand, this little hair thing.
Thank you.
I find these freaking things everywhere I go in my house, and now I'm finding them. And then this.
Well, you live with females.
Well, yes. But she screams at the top of her lungs, "That's where it is. Were you looking for this thing?"
Yeah, I was looking for. Okay, so I had to go after this. I worked like 10 other jobs.
Good radio,
jobs.
Christian. It's a hair tie. Yeah.
For I already said that. I said it.
You said these things.
But I said this hair thing. I keep finding it.
This hair thing doesn't give it like a specific.
All right, so but it's a hair thing. It's a hair tie.
Josh, you leaned in a little heavy on Christian. You could have done a better job of explaining what was in your hand.
You're right.
Roxy, you got your hair tied.
Some people at home could be picturing bobby pins, clips. Okay. It's a hair elastic.
Whatever.
And you guys don't understand how essential these are to living as a person with long hair.
Once more, that or water?
Hair elastic. Right.
Yeah.
Makes
hair
sense.
Elastic. There's alternatives to water.
Right.
Yeah, you just find them. If you live with a woman, you just find them. They're in every nook and cranny in the apartment.
Do you ever use them to like tie up bread?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. I do that too. You, Ellis has never done that.
No, he's never bought a loaf of bread.
Ellis not a big carb guy.
I'm trying to be off
anymore.
The carbs,
yeah.
And I'm off the not living anymore. With females. So
12 years ago.
What about a bag of frozen shrimp?
I'm avoiding carbs and I'm avoiding having a woman in my apartment.
Both.
So
right.
How's that going for you?
It's
pretty good so far.
Very peaceful.
Yeah. Well, the playoffs are still going on. So,
oh God, the Super Bowl is going to be. Yeah. Because we're getting back from Arizona, like, on the day of the Super Bowl.
Like,
we're driving back
right
that
around
morning.
When it kicks off.
Yeah, so I'm going to go in my apartment, and I might have the dog come over, but that's it. And then I'm just going to watch it on my huge 75-inch TV. Almost too big.
Good for
I told
you.
Them your secret.
You got a new 75-inch TV?
I got a 75-inch
TV. When? Not why. When?
Oh, a couple weeks ago. When I made the move.
It's good. I like that
when
move.
I made, it's
too big?
It's almost too big.
Why is that?
Because it's a big fucking
thing. I want more. I want more. Give me more.
Yeah,
and
dude.
And I want the wireless surround sound. I want it all.
Well, that's what I got. I got the wireless surround sound,
see?
So there's no
you're
wires.
Doing it right.
Because you would not believe the amount of people. I used to, if I would take a picture of the TV in the old place, and there's like wires hanging out in the back, it's like it wasn't mounted, and I didn't really care.
Right. You know, mounted this one, too.
Everybody would be like, it's not about what the image that I took a picture of. It's like, what are all those wires doing back there? So now there's no
dude,
nobody
you know what's
wires.
Weird? I'm very impressed with you, by the way, right now.
Well,
because this is I don't
hair
know.
Ties?
I just don't know who I'm talking to right now, because normally you wouldn't care. You just let the wires hang out all over the place. You wouldn't get the big screen TV. You just kind of be content with what you're doing. Instead, you splurged.
It's not a bad point, Christian.
You went and you did your thing.
Yeah.
And you had a nice television. You got rid of the sloppy wires and you gave yourself a nice entertainment system. And what that means to me is there will be a day now that I will want to sneak out of my house and come to your
Well,
place.
You should, because that's the thing, is the last time I was living on my own, we had, there was a number of, you know, things that would stop one from progressing into a relationship eventually.
Right.
The cereal box
cereal
tower.
Boxes,
I'm not even going
to
say
it. The twin bed.
You don't need to. It's
no,
there. It lives in
the twin bed, the mountains of six-pack holders.
Right.
The
so
collection.
Many, so many, stop.
Go. Please, go
you,
ahead.
You, until this move, had a twin bed?
No, this was the first move I've had since I got out of a relationship. And then the last place I lived before I was like in a relationship, I had a twin bed. And Makuka came over one time.
Yeah.
And
like
he
what
saw
age
the,
are we talking?
He 30, saw the twin bed. Probably 30.
No.
Yeah.
Oh,
and Makuka came
bed.
Over. No, I was 30 or 31 because Makuka comes over and he's like, Mark, you're above 30 now.
Yeah.
You cannot still sleep in a twin bed.
I mean, you shouldn't have a twin bed above 18.
Yeah.
Like below 8, I mean, whatever it is.
Foxy is horrified.
Yeah.
She's like,
but here's the best part.
It worked in the previous place, though, because the previous place before that one, which you saw, was the twin bed was small enough to where I could put it into the closet.
He doesn't like change.
I had a walk-in closet in a studio apartment, so I could put the twin bed into the closet.
What part of this are you saying worked?
The fact that I could sleep in the closet, close the closet, and then
it's like Harry Potter.
It was exact, and it was
Dobby
some
the
of the best slumber I've ever had.
Or like Harry and the Dursleys.
Yeah,
bullet holes coming through.
Did
the
nobody ever come sleep over?
Didn't want to.
I had a couple dalliances in the closet.
You did.
I will say though, Mark played
in
away
the
games.
Twin bed in the closet. You brought women there.
And that was but never a repeat viewing. Just once.
Between
there were a couple of repeat viewings.
When did you move? When did you move out of that apartment? Do you remember what year?
2010.
No, it was earlier than that.
No, it was later than
did
that.
Did you say something before? Like, did you have to justify?
No, it was 2008,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, because I moved out of my place that I lived across the street from me for a little bit.
Right,
The one that was the one bedroom with the mountains, that was like 2012, wasn't it?
That's the one we're talking about. No, that was 2009. Okay. And
that was 2009 to 2012.
Right.
So that one, that apartment was where I first became friends with Mark Ellis and, you know, kind of pushed him on his way to, maybe we should get like a double bed. Maybe we should do something about your room. We were also shooting videos in that, in the bedroom. Yeah. So it was kind of tough. That was also the same apartment where I let Mark borrow my tuxedo and he's like, I think it's in my closet. And it was legitimately under an entire pile of clothes in the corner of the closet. He pulls it up.
The closet with the bed in it?
No, different closet, different apartment.
It's not a starter tuxedo. It's a backup tuxedo that he had probably lying in his closet.
You know better than this.
We had to wear it.
You know how he feels about clothes.
For a photo shoot.
Yeah.
You shouldn't have done it.
It was not.
Look at you defending yourself. You're on the ropes.
Tuxedo anymore.
Men can just wear each other's tuxedos. You guys don't feel like the same size.
We pretty much have the same size.
Yeah. Really?
You got 40 clean. Regular.
Yeah. He's a little more shouldery than me, but I got pretty good shoulders.
Oh, I don't like that you're not owning this.
No, I do own it.
All right.
But again,
but also like, between
did
those.
Did it ruin the guy's week? No. Did it ruin his day? Possibly.
Did you ruin his tux? Was it ruined?
It was not. This is not a Vera Wang we're talking about.
This is
a thrift store, Goodwill level tux.
I don't care if the thing is worth $2. He's lending you something. You should take care of it. And this is coming from me. I leave shit around all the time. But when it comes to other people's things and I'm borrowing it, that's why whenever I lend out a DVD or a Blu-ray, it's like, you better treat that thing like you just bought it at Best Buy and respect it. If I find it underneath a pile of clothes, a tux, that's the last thing you ever borrowed from me ever.
You didn't apologize to him?
I gave him an orange suit.
How's that doing?
It's his now.
You gave it to him. The classic one.
That's what I feel bad about, because I think Makugi gave me the orange tux and the orange suit, and he's like, look, I know what's going to happen to this, so just go ahead and take it.
And you take care of that thing, though.
I do take care of that thing. Because
you kept
wear
it. And
I learned.
Right. This is his now.
This is what a friendship is all about. I was going to clean the tux and give it back to him. I just hadn't gotten around to it by the time he came over.
Next question. In a year. What is a cereal tower?
Oof.
That's a question I'm going to refer to my lawyer.
Okay, so at this point, Mark and I, we become good friends, and we were both single at the time, so we were going out heavy to like a comedy store, then coming back, hitting Taco Bell. I'd pass out on one of his 6 recliners because he had like multiple recliners. There was no couch. There was like
you had no couch.
It was just recliners.
There was one red couch.
I had a red couch. Twin bed in the closet.
I had a red IKEA couch.
No, this is a different apartment.
This is a different apartment.
This is the apartment that you moved
from. So we went from the twin bed in the closet to a twin bed in a one bedroom, and this is when, and then from like about 2009 to 2012, you were mostly playing away games. Yeah. When I mean with ladies, you were like, "Hey, what's your place like?" Because I can't bring you to this twin bed up against a wall because I'm not in the dorm room
very
anymore.
Very generous to say I was playing away games. I was mostly scrimmaging.
Pretty much.
Exactly in the season,
right? And so the first time I went over there, I was like, "All right, so maybe Mark hasn't cleaned in a little bit." Right, I'm just thinking that
it's a weird kind of messy. It wasn't like a filthy mess.
It was not dirty, just messy.
It was a controlled mess.
Yes, it's not like when you go over there and there's some people that have a mess and it's like, I'm not going over this filthy. There's like tomato sauce on the wall.
Yeah,
and there's
dishes in the sink.
You never worried about cockroaches come over. It was just a sloppy mess.
It's
a mess.
It's the same thing that people accuse me of when they see the back of my car. It's recycling, and I don't take the recycling.
Your car is literally a moving recyclable can.
Yes,
it's really what it is.
Yes, it's like if a homeless person owned a Ford Fusion. That's exactly what it would be. So the cereal box tower was boxes that I was going to recycle, and they just kind of stacked up because I ate a lot of cereal back in the day.
All cereal boxes.
It would go about yay high.
They were big, and they stayed there forever. And the Terrell Owens cereal.
Yeah. Like a table.
Terrellos.
My brother got me a box of TOs because
Do you still have those?
No, I think I might have the box of TOs still because my brother used to live in Rochester, like near Buffalo, right, in upstate New York. And I told him, like, man, do they still have boxes of Flutie Flakes up there? And Robbie's like, yeah, you Flutie Flakes for cereal every day. And I'm like, those are valuable. And I was like, go, please get me a box of Flutie Flakes. I would love to have a box of Flutie Flakes as a memento.
Doug Flutie was a quarterback in Buffalo.
Doug Flutie. Was a quarterback in Buffalo.
Flutie flakes? Do they look like?
Like a
they
local
look like
cereal.
Flakes with Flutie on the cover?
Yeah. It was kind of like a Wheaties, like a local Wheaties, and I thought it might be like a valuable item. I'm a big fan of Doug Flutie, so.
Sure.
Robbie goes through, he's like, Mark, I got bad news. they're done with Flutie Flakes, but I got you a box of T.O.'s.
Yeah.
So Terrell Owens had an unremarkable stint with the Bills, and so they're called T.O.'s, and they're like Cheerios. So that's
the story.
And that was the new cereal.
I think I still have
somewhere.
That,
yeah.
I think I still have it.
But anyway, I came in and really gave Mark a stern talking to about
I remember
life
that talking to him
in general.
Because
and not that I had my life
20.
Together. Yeah. I was like, Mark, you
but that aspect you do.
What's that?
That aspect
as far as cleanliness
about,
you always had like a dope place, I feel like, even though you had some weird roommates.
Yes, definitely had some weird roommates.
Right.
Well, that's the thing about living on your own, though, is that you, even if you have a roommate, even if it's somebody like it's like Christian or McCougar, and it's like, we're just bros, we live together. There's a certain level of decorum that you have to maintain at all times because somebody else lives there. Like me and my buddy Doug used to live together, and we eventually, like, we would break down. We'd play toilet paper chicken is what I called it. Like, who's going to break down and go buy more toilet paper first?
Yeah.
Who's going to get sick of Burger King napkins and have to actually go out to the store and that kind of stuff? But you want to maintain a certain level of cleanliness if somebody else is living there. If you're living by yourself, all bets are off.
Yeah.
Right. Well, good.
I feel so differently. Like living by myself, my place is immaculate because nobody's there to mess it up.
Yeah, it's different though. I think sometimes with and with men and women, I can tell you too. Yeah. Sometimes.
Wow.
I mean, my current roommate is a real stickler about everything. I mean, we got throw pillows perfectly chopped.
Right.
She's always putting pillows in different places. She's constantly moving the entire house around. I guarantee you, when I come back from Arizona this weekend, the entire living room will have now been moved to something else that is like now more feng shui.
Why won't you let her change the couch? She clearly wants to. She posts about it on Instagram all the time.
That couch is the greatest
legendary couch
of all time.
So it's a very comfy couch.
I will say that it's comfortable.
You sink into it.
Greenland couch talk debuts tomorrow. But I do
have a series coming out called Marriage Couchling.
Yeah, so. I like that. Yeah. All right, I do want to talk. There are a lot of things that's going to be talked about on today's show. There's a lot of big announcements. And the first big announcement is today at 11:30, Benedict Wong from Doctor Strange.
Absolutely.
He's going to be in today talking about his new show, and we're excited to have him on at 11:30. He's coming in to the show. He'll be live in studio. That's a lot of fun. We will also have a very special guest at 10:30 calling in, one by the name of Bob Finstock. The audience did get... Thank you. They did get the trailer to the channel itself to 1500.
He had 1500 subscribers on YouTube.
1500 subscribers on YouTube.
Still not one of them.
And so what he's gonna tell us what he's gonna do because he's gonna release one of the episodes because the thing is we've been playing the clip a lot.
Winning goldfish here.
Now once I see the trailer itself, it's gonna say one or two things to me. There's more sound clips to pull, or we're never gonna play any of this stuff ever again.
The episode's coming out though, right?
He's going to tell us
trailer first.
He's going to call and tell us where it stands because he did hit it. I don't think he expected to hit it that fast, and he's calling in to tell us. But what I will say about this clip, I have found something very special about it. Not only the fact that people have signs and T-shirts and all that stuff, it has become a therapeutic thing, and I never knew it could be. Riley, are you in there? All right, let's get Riley on the mic too because we're going to talk about this. This just happened out of nowhere yesterday. So and the Collider Live audience is a big part of why this happened, and I am so happy for it because I think it's a new thing. So Riley had come in yesterday and he showed me like this troll comment on Twitter. So he just responded saying nothing except the gif of Win a Goldfish here. Mm-hmm. The next thing I see is all these other troll comments from everywhere, from just not to us, just in general in life. And there's responses of the Win a Goldfish gif starting to play, and all these It's so fun.
It's like a perfect retort.
Riley, tell me how excited you were to find the retort that you don't have to actually get yourself heated.
Yeah, you don't get heated anymore. You just respond. No matter what it is, it's like, you suck at Star Wars. Great. Win a goldfish here. They're complaining about time codes. Win a goldfish here. And the wonderful thing is that everybody is now responding.
With the win a goldfish here.
They jumped on my lead and they kept going. And this guy's like, what is this? Why do you do this?
And it's someone.
It probably pisses trolls off like 10 times.
Because they don't know what it is. And like someone had written today, someone's like, I like the trivia contest a lot better than it was WWE based. Win a goldfish, yeah. Win a goldfish. I don't know what it is. Like someone tells you, like last week you could have used it a lot. A
couple goldfishes here.
And even you just respond back to comments, I don't know what it is. I think Finstock has struck gold with this win a goldfish here because it is such a therapeutic troll repellent. I don't know why. I love it. It's like tweet something out. I'm just going to put that GIF. Thank you to whoever made the GIF.
Just kind of smooths everything
over. It feels
over.
Great. Try it. I'm telling you.
Has he said thank you to you yet? Because, like, you are doing this. Does he not realize that?
I don't care. It's one of the...
It is a lot of you championing it, but getting 100%. To 1,500, I mean, I remember back in the dark ages when you and I got to 1,000 subscribers on YouTube, and we're like, we've made it. We're somebody in this industry. So for that to get 1,500, I think that's
great.
Impressive.
Yeah. I'm just telling you, if you see anywhere, if it's directed towards you guys, if it is not directed towards you guys, whatever, if you see it, if you see any troll comment at all, just post the GIF and watch how wonderful you feel about it.
I tell you,
it feels amazing.
All
you got to type in for GIF is win a goldfish, and it comes up.
Okay.
Does it make me bitter that I have the same amount of GIFs as this goldfish, and I'm not happy about that?
Look, maybe you should come up with a puppet show. You know what I'm trying to tell you?
Does that make me bitter? Yeah.
You can't get bitter about that kind of stuff.
So good.
You know, like people just have like odd senses of humor, and then they tap into something. And you can't really you can't be like, oh well, why did I think
let
of
the
that?
Wave
I've
hit
been
you.
Doing this. It's like it's a very creative thing. No, wait, is it my cup of tea?
No.
But I saw him last night celebrating 1,500. He's my buddy, so I think that's an achievement. And then when he also, I think he tagged like Adult Swim in it, and I was like, maybe. Because Adult Swim does some experimental comedy like that.
See, that's why I need to see the episode. From the trailer, I can't tell you.
Are you really expect me to believe you have not seen the episode?
Oh, I swear to God, I haven't seen it.
Yeah. Really?
That's why I tried to push everybody to 1,500, because I want to see the episode.
He has not showed you the episode.
No,
it's
not ready yet.
You saw it?
Your biggest hype man, has not sent it to you and been like, hey, can you put your
eyes on it? I've been hearing about this Little Bobby and the Juice, drunk or whatever, from Bobby Finstock for the last 3 years. We were on a ride home from Mark Riley's grandma's house from Newport all the way to L.A. Both of his girlfriend, my wife, fell asleep, and he talked to me for an hour and a half about Little Bobby and the Juice. And I was like, dude, just make it. Go ahead. In the back of my head, knowing full well that maybe he might make it someday, but in the same time, knowing full well that it could be the most offensive thing ever to be put on YouTube. Okay?
Could also be very funny.
Or it could be very funny.
Or both.
Yes, or both. I don't know.
I was with Sarah Stratton yesterday, and I didn't think she would have any idea what I was talking about, because they haven't done a show together for, I don't know, 2 years.
A while,
Since Box Office Breakdown, and I was like, have you checked out Finstock's trailer yet? And she was like, have I checked it out? He called me 3 years ago to sew costumes for them.
That's amazing.
Did she sew costumes?
Yes.
Interesting.
It's very detailed.
Like, he's been working on this thing for
the series
years.
It's not. You can say one thing about him. He is not lazy. He is getting it done. Now, what he got done,
he's
we don't know.
Interesting kind of lazy. He's a hardworking guy that always seems like he's not working.
Correct.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
Right? That's good. That's a good way to frame it.
Yeah, exactly.
Here's one thing you can't respond with to win a goldfish here is that our show in Arizona is now a single show. It's at 9 p.m.
Oh, yeah.
Doors open at 8. So if somebody says, hey,
nine?
I got a ticket.
What time?
It's
the ninth show?
It's at 9.
It's 9.
It's at 9.
They were right.
Sorry,
Cobbster. It's at 9.
Started again.
So if somebody says, hey, I don't know what's going on, you can't respond with win a goldfish here.
You have to
say, hey, Mark Ellis is headlining Pub Rock Live in Arizona.
Right.
Hosted by Josh McCuga, Ken Napsok. Doors open at 8.
That's not a troll
tweet.
That's
not a troll tweet.
Then you could say win a goldfish after you explained it.
After you explained it.
No, I think you save the goldfish for the trolls.
You save the trolls. So
you can't overdo it, because then it becomes the remember the Simpsons episode, the I Didn't Do It Boy?
No.
Like Bart says, I didn't do it. He's on a hit sitcom, and he says, I didn't do it. And everybody loves him
for
3 weeks, and then they kick him out the back door because he's just known as the I didn't do it voice.
You want to make sure, I'm telling you, it's a special kind of thing to where you see these troll comments out there, and I want it to catch on. Like there's like political arguments going on out there. I would love to see win a goldfish.
That's where the goldfish really shines.
Yes.
If there's some sort of back and forth. Yeah, respond to Trump's tweet.
Or
anybody. Trump's tweets, I fully authorize.
Anybody, to any politicians, left or right, if they're going back and forth and saying stupid stuff, win a goldfish,
yeah?
Win a goldfish, yeah?
That to me could be something global. I would love to see it just popping up everywhere. So celebrity says something stupid, hit him with it. Somebody, you know, an athlete hits him who said something stupid, hit him with it. That GIF should be everywhere, and I hope that it catches on. I really do. I love it. I'll do it myself.
It's nice for a boy to have a dream.
It really is.
What I'll say.
I will say, your passion for this equals nothing in my life. Because listen, I wanted to be the next host of Jeopardy since I was 10. Your passion for this equals nothing like that. You're like, I don't understand it, but I understand that it's sort of funny.
That's how you understand it. Because when it first starts, all you hear is when a goldfish and you go, yeah, that's stupid. And then you hear it again. And then you see
the goldfish.
No, I get it.
But you see the puppet. And that, yeah, and
you
is
blonde.
I know what you're talking about.
I'm just telling you. I'm saying is, as it keeps registering, it gets less annoying and more funny.
Or
that's not that you can't. You can't say that.
That's what happened with Dorian.
Okay, that's one example.
He's more important
Dorian
than you.
Okay,
he's a social media guy here.
He's a much more significant voice at Collider than I am.
Yes.
I dare say everybody in your life may not feel the same way. My point.
I would venture to say
people
that
you live with.
No, my wife hates it.
It
of course
not
she does.
I'm shocked.
Especially now that my 7-year-old was getting ready this morning, brushing her teeth, and she goes, "When a goldfish?"
It doesn't affect me the same way it's affecting you. I will say that.
I will say that these three people, it is affecting nowhere near what it is. Because I will tell you this, as far as troll comments go, I will never respond with "Win a goldfish" here because
should.
I don't understand it.
I'm telling you, try it once.
Okay, do you guys remember the movie Easy A with Emma Stone?
Yes.
It starts off the weekend where she keeps singing that song by whoever, and she hates it, and then it grows on her, and then she hates it again, and then it's her favorite song, and she can't stop singing it.
Like me with Artichoke.
With "Win a Goldfish" here, it's not doing any of it. It's legitimately like half of a plain bagel with no cream cheese.
Well, you've been hating on it since it came out.
I have not been hating on
it. It didn't sound like hate at all.
I don't understand why it's such a good response to a troll.
I don't know. I can't explain that.
Okay. All right. So we're on the same page.
That's the thing is that I can't explain it.
I'm not hating on anything. Because I tell you what, I'm more anticipated to see the first episode of Bobby and Juice than anything I've seen in a long time.
Your question is valid, and I understand it. You're asking like, why is it so fun?
Yes.
I have no answer for you except it feels amazing.
Okay.
Riley and I yesterday just fell in love with it.
Here's what I feel like this thing has become, is I feel like everybody's just like kind of looking at it, and this is like Christian's the coach of the football team, and this is his kid. So, of course, his kid's going to be playing quarterback. Yeah. And we're all like, does he have the best arm? I don't care. It's his kid. So what are you going to do about it?
I would feel that the same way.
Five interceptions in the first quarter. Right. You're like, whoa.
I would have felt the same way had I not seen the responses back. Because I could tell, because when Riley was the first one to do it, and as I saw all the fans start to do it, they started getting a kick out of it.
That's the interesting thing.
You're gonna see billions of men after this show today.
I always walk into it. It's fine.
I think you could argue, you could make the argument that you and Riley are two of the most. Social media gets to you guys
more.
It has gotten under your skin historically.
I put Roke up there too.
Correct.
I put Roke up there too. Sure.
Oh, yeah.
Sure. But so the fact that you guys, who are very sensitive about certain things online, are able to use it and it acts as a pacification technique for your mental
state. It's therapeutic.
State.
Good use of pacification.
And I said that.
There you go.
It might not be for everybody, but I'm telling
you. I want to be on board so bad.
Just try
because
it once.
I see the joy you get out of it, and you guys know I'm Can I Come. I want to be part of everything. I'm trying so hard.
You get so many troll comments, though, too. Try it once and see how you feel.
I will try it.
Just try it.
I'm not fully on Josh's side where he said he'll never use it to combat the trolls, but I am not seeing it.
I'm just saying try it once because it's not the fact, it's not just when you respond to it, it's then watching everyone else that follows you also respond to it. That's the most fun part. I'm just telling you to try it.
I might be digging my own grave here.
No,
cops are here.
No.
That's cool if you guys like tweet it, like fans and stuff, just don't include me on it. Please. Because
that's a fair point.
Yeah, I blame myself because I responded to the person.
Oh, okay.
And then all I saw because I didn't know
you saw the gifts,
I had no idea because I wasn't on the show yesterday and then Riley explained to me and then now I just keep getting them and I'm wondering if I can mute gifts.
Yes, I'm with you on that one.
You shouldn't be tagged on it.
No. It's my fault because I was the one who responded to that person.
And I guarantee you forever. That we'll be in the crowd because at the Schmoedown on Saturday, more than 3 to 4 people yelled out, "Win a goldfish here." And that's not annoying.
I got 50 tweets this week being like, what goldfish? Where can I win it? Where do I win the goldfish?
I would keep it in the online space.
Keep it on the gift.
Please.
But I would not keep it in a live setting. Yeah.
Please.
Is he on the phone yet?
No.
Okay. Well, tell me when he's on the phone.
But you know who we should get on the phone? You know the first two, the first official image of Will Smith and Martin Lawrence together with the badges on.
You think they'll pick up?
I mean, if they want to call in, I'm glad to talk to
them. I'm working on trying to get you that set visit.
Man.
Hey, Christian, it's Cody again.
Yes, sir.
He's on the line.
All right. All right. So listen, we've been talking about this thing for a little bit here. 1,500 subscribers. It happened. Finstock, are you on the line?
Cool.
All I know about heroes is that people need one.
Is that what you think you are?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I think the show is the hero. Look, here's the deal. You know, yes, the 1,500. Thank you. Thank everybody and all the fans out there to get us to this.
This is the loudest he's ever talked in a microphone.
Take off like this. It's pretty fantastic in a lot of ways. And, you know, as promised, we're going to drop the pilot early, you know?
When are you dropping the pilot? You're supposed to drop it after 1,500. Are you going back on that?
No. Listen, here's the deal. The editors in Croatia are hard at work putting the bells and whistles on this thing. This thing was supposed to be, you know, we were going to drop it in March, but now, you know, with the 1,500s coming so quickly, we had to put it into overdrive.
Okay. So when are we going to see it?
We have a trailer. So, the trailer is live right now.
An extended
pilot episode.
Oh, so an extended trailer of the episode you are going to drop. That's what you released today. So then people will be able to see the other one in a couple of weeks, the actual episode itself.
Actually, we thought the episode itself is a romantic comedy version. So what better day than to drop it than Valentine's Day?
Okay, there you go. So Valentine's Day will be the pilot episode.
It will be the pilot.
Okay, the pilot, but the extended
5,000 by then it's come.
All right, the extended trailer though is up right now on the channel itself.
Yes, on the Little Bobby and the Juice trailer, the extended trailer is on there. It's about a minute long. Look, the first mega trailer was 8 episodes packed into a minute and 44 seconds. That's why it was so haywire.
Right.
You know what I mean? But we try to get everything in there.
Do you win a goldfish in the first episode, or do people have to wait for that?
They got to pay for that.
Okay.
That's to pay for.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, what's going to happen is February 14th, you will see magic.
Okay, well, listen, here's the thing. I don't know what it is about Carl, the little blonde puppet, but I like him. Here's the thing. I'm going to watch this trailer. I'm going to see if there's any sound clips that we can pull from that, if there's any new ones. But if the actual episode itself is not funny, I'm never going to promote the show ever again.
I 100% agree with you.
Okay.
And trust me, it is, like I've been saying for a long time, this will be the best show on the internet.
All right.
There's no question about it.
Have you been trying to sell it somewhere, or have you, or is that?
Yeah, I've had. We're going to Adult Swim next week.
Okay.
Did you know Carl was going to be the breakout star?
You know, he's just one of about 40 characters that we have power packed in this whole season.
Okay. He just happened to pop in the trailer.
He's just one.
All right.
He's probably my fourth favorite.
Okay.
There are some other people here that are going to change people's lives.
All right.
Like I said, in this kind of social environment and this climate we're living in, this is the perfect show.
All right. Well, listen, last thing, I was given false information yesterday by Riley because I had thought that the Carl's voice, Win a Goldfish Here, was not you. Riley said it is you. Can you confirm or deny that voice is you or not?
The voice is not me.
Okay.
Win a Goldfish Here. Win a Goldfish Here.
Co-creator, Mike's voice.
Okay.
We did all our voices in the whole show, over 45 characters. It wasn't an easy thing to do. This was a two-man operation.
All right. Well, listen. Listen. We're going to look out. We're going to check the trailer out. We're going to see. You can watch the trailer now. The episode will be up on the 14th. I will check out the trailer probably during the break and see if there's anything in there or anything that I should say. I don't know who you are and cut you out of my life.
No. I totally agree with that.
All right. Don't cut him out of your life. Everybody needs a little fin stuff.
Also.
Yeah.
The origins of Win a Goldfish Here.
Yeah.
We're from my uncle who ran a goldfish booth in the St. Gennaro fan.
It's actually true.
That's the one on Mulberry Street.
Then this is actually a true story.
Yes, that's exactly where it is.
Yeah.
So he was the one. But he might have murdered my dad, but sometimes you got to take the good with the bad. You know what I'm saying?
Is that the truth?
Yeah.
Wow. All right. Listen, there's so much more to talk to you about, but it's just not now. You want to talk about this? We'll be here for another 20 minutes.
You can't drop bombs like that and then just, all right, take it easy. We're not sure if you.
I'm just saying, I really.
I'm going to go investigate murder.
Everybody backing this. And I guarantee you guys, you will not be disappointed.
Well, thank
That's
you.
For sure.
Oh, thank you, Finstock. Well, I'm going to watch it during the break. We'll see
you. No, thank you.
All right. You
thank
got it.
You. You good
work,
Tom.
You're welcome.
Congrats, bud.
Good work, Bobby.
All right, brother. We'll see you later. All right. So there go. There he goes.
Never met anyone like him.
No, not at all. The extended trailer is up. I am very curious to what the hell that's going to be like. I'll watch that during the break. But yeah, there you go. So there's Finstock, and we'll see the episode on February 14th. Someone else who's back in town that we really talk about is Alex. You try to figure out who Alex is. Alex
Marzona,
is,
yeah. Yep. Yeah. Very talented.
Kid kept saying he was also in New York, cracked out a couple tunes. Good, I saw the clips, really good singer. But
Marzona,
yeah. But listen, he was missed way more by the fans than anybody in this room. He does the time codes on the episode. And, I mean, the fans have been brutal about the time codes. Oh, you got to have the time codes. They don't want to hear us talk about stuff.
What do you time code on this show? Is it like, so the cereal box conversation
Correct.
Is at 10?
He segments it out. He's like, Mark talks about his messy apartment. Okay. And like, you know, Finstock calls in. Yeah. And then they're like, their fans are very upset that the time codes went away. So Alex is back and the time codes will be back on this episode. So there you go.
I feel like people rely on time codes too much for their own
their
personal
lives.
Life. Yeah. You know, it's like, just if you take a little time and you can explore the whole show.
I think you'll all enjoy how much time and effort we put into our conversations in a full 2-hour show. And I think you don't need time codes.
Well, the time codes
are a hindrance towards enjoyment.
The ones, particularly the ones that are on the Schmoedown, baffle me. Because because they always say the match starts like at 13 minutes.
It doesn't happen that much anymore. So a lot of people get banned from the
it's
channel.
Like if you've ever seen one episode of Schmoedown, you know. Fast forward about 10, 15 minutes.
Right, you don't need to do
and
it.
That's the start of the match.
Right.
Like, it takes one extra second to just be like, there it is.
Because, again, win a goldfish here. It's people love to complain. And
okay, don't say it to me.
I'm just telling you. Don't you
dare.
Those people.
Don't you dare.
Those people. Not to you. I'm not calling you.
I am here. I'm not saying it's a live human being.
I'm responding. But I do want, yesterday, I told you on the phone, and we watched his live reaction
to
the news of that. As of right now, confirmed on Tuesday, our guest in studio is going to be Jean-Claude Van Damme.
That's pretty big.
He ran out of the room, scared that.
Pretty excited.
It's Tuesday?
Yeah, Tuesday. What's wrong?
Nothing.
What's wrong with Tuesday?
Whatever.
You don't want to, you're not going to be
Tuesday's
here?
No, Tuesday's exciting.
What's the deal with Tuesday?
Whatever.
Why'd you say it?
It's going to be fine.
Are
what's
you not here on Tuesday?
I'm putting pieces together in my head. Tuesday's great.
Yeah, I mean,
what did you think? Today was Tuesday?
No.
What are you talking about? What's going on in your head now? You already said it on the air. What's happening?
Remember, I told you I'm going on
cruise?
No. I have that show that I'm doing, but I think it's the next Tuesday.
I don't remember what you're talking about.
You don't know what I'm talking about?
You're just
getting Doug with High. I'm going on it.
Oh, yes.
And I asked you about it.
Yeah,
it's on Tuesday, but I think it's actually the next Tuesday,
okay,
so I'll be fine.
There's a chance that I'm not available either. But I don't know my schedule.
I will ask as many hard target questions as you email me.
I just like hard target was such a special
How
movie.
How could you not be here for
to
this?
Me?
What do you got?
Where might you be?
It's a twofold thing. Yeah. I might have to go film something in another part of the
country, the
city
world.
But it's also a thing. It's the weirdest thing, and I don't know when it happened to me. It's like, Van Damme is totally my favorite action star of all time, right?
Mm-hmm.
I just, there's something about meeting anybody now that it doesn't excite me like it used to. And
but
he's
Van
up
Damme?
There. He's up there. Like, I think it happened when I went up to Mark Hamill and got the selfie, and he was so nice and knew who I was. And it was because he was like the ultimate.
Right.
So after Mark Hamill, it's like,
Jean-Claude's got to be on the list. Top 5.
I do get a little upset when I see people just like look at this selfie I got. With this person.
But it's not a selfie, it's an interview.
This is a conversation.
It's an interview.
This is a conversation.
A
you have to talk to him.
What am I going to say to him that he hasn't heard 1,000 times?
But don't
you can't
think
like that.
Wow.
You can't think
I'm
like that.
Shocked. I'm shocked to hear this point of view.
I occasionally, I have self-doubt, or I just feel like because here's
you
the
can
thing.
Do it.
You don't want to meet somebody and then have them disappointed in who you are. Right. You don't want them walking out of here being like, that Ellis is a real fucking loot. You know, right. I want to I want to walk out of here with him. And like be like, let's go to yard.
If you don't show up, you can't walk out with him.
You're not going to know.
I know.
You're not going to play in the game.
Not that. The other thing is like, look, I'll be fine. Okay. If I'm on my deathbed and my grandkids, who I'll probably never have, are like, hey, what's your big regret in life? It's not going to be not meeting Vander.
He doesn't feel that way.
No, are you kidding me?
You can drag this guy out.
There are five people in this life that I'm still going to get starstruck by when I meet them and then be a schoolboy and ask as many questions as humanly possible.
Giddy
Will Smith, Martin Lawrence, Bo Jackson, Jean-Claude Van Damme, and Charlize Theron. That's it. That's all I've got.
Oh, man, I should have taken you to the Critics' Choice Awards then.
Was she there?
Yeah.
She's on my list, too.
Yeah.
Bo Jackson was at the Critics' Choice Awards?
He won. Okay. He won every award.
Here's the thing, though. If I know somebody's in the crowd, it will jack me up. Like, if it's a professional athlete.
You're ready to go. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, if somebody came to me backstage in Arizona, like, and they're like, hey, Mark, we don't know how it happened. Bo Jackson's here.
The jokes go up tenfold.
So
right.
Keyed up. Right? Yeah. Right. I don't know if it'd be better or worse, but I would be
the energy
feeling
would be
it.
Good.
It was like that night. Do you remember that night we were at the Improv and Paul McCartney was in the crowd?
No, yes. I was not there.
Yes,
so
I do.
We're at the Improv, and it was like, yo, Paul McCartney's in the crowd, and Adam Ray was about to go up, and he goes, I'm freaking out. Like he was. I've never seen Adam Ray nervous before going on stage before. Paul McCartney's here. He's like right next to the stage. It was incredible.
That's cool.
He'd be the one. If Paul McCartney's coming in here, I'm gonna.
I mean, Steve Perry and Journey, still never met him. I honestly think to Talleyrand. Apparently, he shows up there sometimes.
Yeah,
I'm in.
Who has been the biggest person that's come seen a set of yours, or that you found out was in the audience?
Van Halen, right?
Eddie Van Halen.
Wow.
David Lee Roth too.
Wow.
Did
you talk to them after?
I talked to Roth. I've hung out with Roth a couple times.
Wow.
And it's cool. It's cool for like 10 minutes.
Does he know that you're like a huge fan?
Yeah, the first time I met him was in the back of the Comedy Store, and we were and he is David Lee Roth, like that's who he is. He's just your crazy drunk uncle, and I happened to be wearing a Van Halen hat, just randomly talking to him, and he's going on for like 10 or 15 minutes, just me and him about what it was like when he was in EMT in New York and like all these crazy stories, and then he's just talking and he's just owning the room even though it's just me and him, and then he stops and he sees my hat and he's like, oh, hey, you're having a real good time right now, huh? It's like, yes, sir, I am. And then 5 minutes later, it's like, all right, well, I got to go, Mr. Roth.
Yeah.
You know, he never wants to stop talking.
Well, that's awesome. My brother has been lucky enough, you know, working for EA, that a lot of times when they do EA sports stuff, they like meet a lot of these bigger name, you know, football players or whatever. And a lot of times they're kind of quiet. But he went out to dinner with Joe Montana, and he said that Joe Montana talked to them for like 4.5 hours about football stories. I mean, that's like the coolest thing that can ever happen
that's
to
what you. Wanted. Yeah,
to any of us like common folk, all we want to hear is like, what was it like on 4th and 3, right? And you roll around the pack, and then you hit, you know, it's like that's the kind of stuff you want,
that's
and they
great.
Are happy to regale you.
And
it's
you float out of that restaurant.
Yeah,
you are so excited.
And they know that they've been doing it for long enough that they know that I just gave those people the time of their life.
And then you go to a Hollywood star's birthday party. And you CTO, you're like, what's up, man? He's like, no pictures. And I was like, I was just saying hey.
Right.
So go F yourself, dude. I really don't care.
Paul McCartney,
did that happen to you?
Yeah.
Paul McCartney has said that before many times.
Pictures.
Is that he realizes, that he realizes what this means to people to meet him. Where it's a person to him, but like that's why occasionally he still rides the subway or he just walks into Starbucks because he knows that it's just like a day for him. It's like 5 seconds for him, but he knows that that interaction means it will be
it's a story
about
on the radio
for
yes.
the rest
it's
just, of
it's,
that,
it's a
that
moment.
Person's
yeah.
life.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
that,
yeah.
Did you guys watch the Bill Murray stories on Netflix?
Still haven't seen it. That I need to take like a good night, a good evening, and make that.
Just people who have like met him over the years.
So this documentarian is from New Jersey. He actually did a pretty good job. It's an hour and 10 minutes, right? And it's just interviewing the people that were part of those urban legend Bill Murray stories, right? Where the one where he went into the birthday party and started singing karaoke, the one where he went and was washing dishes in a house in Scotland during a frat party in like outside St. Andrews, and like all the people talking about how cool it was to meet Bill Murray, and just that he was just this guy that knew the sense of what it was, and that he just was there to have fun, and what he kind of changed, like come in, come out, like a phantom in the night. You know what I mean?
It's awesome.
It's a
know,
cool thing.
You know who used to do that type of stuff too was Dave Chappelle. He would go to colleges and perform, and then just show up at parties and hang out with people and do that type of thing. He might still do that. I have no idea.
That's what we all aspire to do. And so, like, I like doing crazy stuff like that. But the problem is, if I do it, then somebody's like, "Oh, we have Mark Elsey here washing dishes last night," and then you have to explain to everybody else who Mark Elsey is.
Right.
Like Chappelle or McCartney or Bill Murray. It's like, whoa, he was here. It's like, who's that again?
And it still wouldn't resonate because a fan would come by and be like, "Man, Ellis really hit the dumps. He's like washing dishes in the back." All right, listen. There's something else.
I used to be on the internet.
There's something else that, like I said last night, if you're following me on Twitter. I had announced. There's a big announcement, really big announcement.
God, this is a packed show with announcements.
It is. Big, huge announcement when it comes to Collider Live. There's some stuff that it's been in the works.
Here.
Yeah, you're still here. We've been talking about it, and we haven't. Thank you. I'll play the music. That's fine. Our big announcement for the remainder of Collider Live, what we're going to do, starting, this starts soon, kids, starting on Monday.
This Monday.
This Monday, starting, was that February 3rd, I believe? February 3rd?
Sure.
I think that's February 3rd.
It's the 4th.
Is it the 4th?
It's the 4th.
All right, whatever it is.
8th.
Yeah.
It's not the 8th. on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, Collider Live goes 5 days.
Wow.
5 days we're going. We're doing Collider Live 5 days a week. It's going to be, Monday will be a two-hour show. Tuesday's 2 hours. Wednesday and Thursday, all 2 hours. And then Friday will be a one-hour show. Still trying to, whether it's kind of a wrap-up slash extra episode
Friday's
on Friday.
Just an hour.
It's an hour. So it's okay. A little extra wrap-up episode.
10 o'clock?
Everyone 10 to 12 and then 10 to 11 on Friday. So 5 days a week for Collider Live.
Congratulations. Thank you're going
so
from
much.
3 to 5.
3 to 5.
To quote one of the famous Bobs from Office Space, this is a pretty big promotion, Pete.
It is a big promotion because the thing is, too, like I said, we're doing pretty good on the YouTubes, but it's the podcast is where it's thriving. So if you guys are not subscribed to us over on Apple Podcasts, please do that, especially if you like the show. Even if you watch on YouTube, subscribe over there. But if you don't do the Apple, then go to Spotify.
Don't do
the Apple. Do the Spotify. Go to Spotify. Download it over there. Do whatever you have to do to get podcasts. You can get it. But keep helping us on the audio. Thank you guys so much for listening, for commenting. It's the interaction with the fans that has really shown that
we are going to light the world on fire.
More people want this show to go. We keep getting the comments every day of make it 5 days a week. Make it five days a week.
Every day.
So yes. There you go. 5 days a week. You get Collider Live starting on Monday.
I have a question, though.
Yeah.
Don't you host Jedi Council on Thursdays at 10 a.m.?
Yeah, Jedi. That's a good call there. Thank you.
I'm just thinking scheduling.
Yes. So
apparently nobody else in this office does.
Yes.
No, I'm not on the Slack.
Jedi Council will not be live anymore.
Hosted by Cobbster.
I'm still hosting it, and Ken will still be on it. It's going to be pre-taped, and it will still air on Thursdays, just a little later with a TBD time. But yeah, next Thursday, Jedi Council will be a little later.
Good.
So there you go.
Good for you.
That's it. Exciting. So 5 days.
I'm looking at the chat.
What are they saying? Are they excited? Or
This one person put R.I.P. Jedi Council. We just talked about this.
Yeah. Jedi Council.
It's gonna be fine.
It's still here. Jedi Council will be. It's pre-taped and it's a little.
Gorlak says make it 6 days a week.
No, thank you. I'm not coming in. I'm already coming on Saturdays to shoot Schmoedowns. Shooting.
We've already got enough on Saturdays and Sundays.
Yeah, yeah. So, but that's it, man. I hope people are excited about it. Keep commenting. Keep. I'm telling you though, the audio though, for everybody who watches every day on YouTube, please go on over and subscribe to the platform and leave a comment over there too. I can't even tell
Apple
you how much
podcast,
it helps.
You mean?
Yeah, if it's Apple Podcasts, you know, if you get podcasts that way, go get it over there, please, because it really helps the show, even if you're watching on video.
Mm-hmm. 100%.
You guys excited?
I'm pumped. Listen, we've been talking Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and honestly, like Thursday and Friday kind of feel a little empty
right
in my life.
Sad in my soul.
I like this. I like doing this. I like being on Collider Live. I don't really like Brett, but that's a different thing.
He'll be back.
Difference
of opinion.
But squashing that, we know that's for the...
No, I'm kidding. Yeah, of course.
I literally just heard about some sort of drama that happened like two weeks ago.
I literally just heard about it.
One of the biggest moments in the show. You got to put this poor bastard.
Anywhere without somebody asking me about it.
It wasn't in my.
You didn't listen to the show.
Vernacular wasn't. Well, no, you know why? Because it wasn't time coded.
No, well, Alex was
that's
here.
That's a callback.
It was
nice work.
Coded.
That's a good callback.
I had a fan of the show come up to me yesterday though, and he said to me, "Can I ask you a question about Collider Live?" And I was sure it was going to be about the SMD, and he goes, somebody really throw a chair at you? And I was like, oh my God, what I thought you were going to ask me about. Yeah, I'm happy to talk about that.
Yeah, when she was watching the Patriots making the Super Bowl, some dirty ass douchebag threw a chair at her.
What?
Yeah. Why are you looking at me? She's right there.
Yeah, I am right here. Yeah. I told you guys I'm still here.
Where were you?
Some bar.
At a bar and like a
here. Look, I'm gonna send you the link to the episode. You can hear the whole story.
No, he wasn't even a Chiefs fan.
I mean, I have
6 hours in a car
yeah.
with Makuga and Knapsack.
Right, you're not gonna listen to Collider Live. I understand.
It's either that or the afternoon's podcast.
Oh, well, yeah.
No, you know what we'll do? We will download the 100th episode of The Wanger Show.
Yes, there you go.
That's what we'll do.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you.
I think Friday. Cobbster, when does it drop?
Oh, it's up now, sir.
Oh, nice. Oh,
100 episodes.
Are the Wangers going to be doing 5 days a week? They're going to be in there?
Well, Cody will be, to his chagrin. Riley will. Yeah, if you didn't know that.
Yeah. No one tells us anything.
That's fine. Well, Cody.
I love the excitement in this room going 5 days a week versus the excitement in that room going 5 days a week. And I'm sure Frank has just left.
The only thing that really changes for Cody is that he's doing, well, I guess, an extra hour for because he's not doing Jedi.
Right.
He usually does Jedi, so he'll be doing that.
But he's going to have to pre-tape Jedi still.
I don't know if he will. They may switch it up now that it's pre-taped. I don't know. He might. But that's...
Cody, I forgot. I keep meaning to bring his gift card in.
Yeah, but Friday's only an hour, so...
And it's going to be the rowdiest hour on YouTube/podcast.
Well, I mean, I think that one of the things that we were talking about doing was that for Friday is that we always wanted to do kind of like fill the void of what...
Beers?
No, what Afterthoughts did, but we should be doing it. Like, we're talking about the things that happened during the week and other things that are happening for next week. And
we can bring on a lot of those guests, too, that like have wanted to come in and hour just like throw, you know what I mean?
There's a lot of
my vote goes for Alex. Alex has so many thoughts that he doesn't speak out loud. I want to hear all his thoughts on
Friday. Why don't you have a rotating guest host every Friday where it's just like somebody else that's not usually on the show?
Basically, it's an hour to play.
Yeah.
So we're going to have...
Get Remsen in here.
The Friday show...
Get Frank in here.
Yeah, well, the Friday show will be... It's again, I've always made reference to the Howard Stern show where it's the after show that they do. That could serve for that hour. We don't know. We're trying to figure it out, but it'll be a full hour, and we'll figure it out pretty fast because it's going to happen. The first one will be next week.
You seem excited.
I'm really
happy
excited.
For you.
I am excited because I think that it's there's so much that has come out of this show, and again, New York just really opened my eyes for a lot of different things.
Yeah.
And when I was there, that's the rub.
Well,
you were
the thing.
You were there. So the meet and greet that we do, which was amazing. People would come up and they'd talk about Mark's comedy. They'd talk about, you know, the Schmoed, I'm excited. And then people would leave and they go, loving Cloud Alive.
Mm-hmm.
Can't, like, Cloud Alive is I listen to it every morning. It's my morning show. And I was like, great.
Well, that was fantastic. The cool thing. And that's why I so badly want Roxy to tag along on one of these things. Because, like, it's something that I've known for a while because I go on the road all the time. And so I felt like it was... I don't know. I felt like I was I got to reveal to you all just how popular you guys are, not just from Collider Live, but just from like being in this space in general for so long, like how much people love you like all over the place, because you guys got to see that. You got to see it in New York at the Comedy Club on Friday. You got to see it at the Schmoedown on Saturday, where it's like, no, you can trap and people know who you are, and it's fun. So it's nice to do a show in a podcast studio, but it's also nice to get out there in the world. And hopefully we all get to do that more this year, because there's fans everywhere that... Like, I don't know why. I don't know why this is their favorite thing. I don't get it.
But you don't listen to it. How would you get it?
No. I'm not talking about Quite a Lot. I'm talking about me. I'm talking about you. I don't know why the Schmoedown. I don't know why the Schmoes. I don't know why you enjoy it so much, but they do, and they show up, and it's awesome, and it's great to see them in person. It's one of the favorite, one of my favorite things
and
I do.
And it's been like a new, I don't know this, it's, to me it seems like, what are those things called?
Clear
the paddles,
whatever.
The paddles.
It feels like that to me in general. With my,
I know it. I was like,
defibrillators. What are the
defibrillators?
Yeah. 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 No, we're adding an extra R in there.
But like, it feels like that to me because when we started for Roxy, how are you? When we started on Movie Talk, it felt like that, like the with those parties, like we'd have those celebration parties, and it felt like there was like the excitement that was going on, and then it's kept on for a little bit, but then it just seemed like there was just like one thing that the space was doing. It just seemed like everybody was kind of doing the same thing again, and it was like, how do you switch it up? I feel like this show has switched it up. I feel the Schmoedown has switched it up. I feel like there's so many different things that we've been doing now that switched up. I feel like the energy's back, and I felt it so much in New York. I definitely feel it in this show. This show is exciting. I think we're going to continue to do so. If you go over to the podcast channel, Collider's podcast channel, where you can find clip outs, those are doing really well over there.
For sure.
We're getting return guests. We're talking about having Ron Perlman back in the studio. I didn't tell you that yet. He might be coming back in.
Have him host on Fridays.
I would love just the Ron Perlman hour. Yeah. Are you kidding me?
Ron Perlman comes in, chills.
But that's it,
he
guys.
He was so great.
He's great.
You got a question. Yeah. Joe M. says, what did I miss? What's the big announcement? So, well, there's a bunch of them, Joe.
Right.
Finstock's channel got to 1,500. Subscribers.
Woo-hoo! Benedict Wong.
And Benedict Wong is coming in next hour. Woo-hoo! And Christian announced 5 minutes ago that Collider Live is expanding to 5 days a week.
Yeah, buddy.
Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Sunday.
Nope, Friday.
I'm sorry, I knew I'd mess up.
The one-hour show on Friday.
Oh,
the little
I would love
bonus
a Sunday
episode.
Show.
You can do it all by yourself.
Yeah, Roxy could come in on Saturday and Sunday and get it out there. But in the vein of getting to see people and getting to see, you know, people show up and stuff. Once again, to reiterate, they originally had two shows slated for us in Phoenix.
Yeah.
It's been combined into one big show. That way, I get to do more time. The afternoon.
How much time are you doing?
I'll probably do at least 60, and then.
So wait. So the show then. The show starts.
Show starts at 9.
9 o'clock.
Doors open at 8. Regardless what your tickets say, that you're going to get an email that just reiterating
right,
this.
So 9
doors
o'clock,
open at 8. Show starts at 9.
Makuga and Ken open.
Yeah, got some really funny local comics going up too.
Okay, and then so they're
and then I'll just.
And you'll do like an hour.
Finish it out.
That's cool.
And Q&A.
How big's the venue?
I think it's about 200. I think right now
sold
we
out?
Have about 190,
oh, sell
185
it out,
sold.
Come on.
So
sell it out.
So
especially,
go pack it.
Yeah.
Maybe
9
you can
PM.
Settle something for us.
Oh.
In
yeah.
New York,
oh, yeah.
Did you feel like Jay Washington and Jen Sturger both ran the light?
In New York, every comic that was on stage that night ran the light.
Did you
except
not get
for me.
Did you not get your full set because of that?
No,
he's being
be
modest.
Was,
he didn't. He's being modest.
It was
modest.
Quick. What I felt bad about, and this is on me because I scheduled the thing, is that I had my buddy who's a hilarious comic, Vince Chang. He usually hosts when I'm in New York because he's fantastic at it. And I was like, well, yeah, you know, I'm doing something different. But I wanted to have him come up and do 5 minutes after me. And then I would go back up and do the Q&A. Because our fans love Vince now, too, because they've seen him so many times. So I had to cut him so I could just go straight through, because otherwise I would have had like 15 minutes on stage.
Was
so
he bummed?
I will say this.
Yeah,
Ken and I.
Yeah. But he was totally cool. He understood. He had a set he had to get to,
okay.
Another set at Broadway Comedy Club. So I'm like, well, I can't end my set in time for you to get on stage so you can get off in time to get to Broadway. So it was kind of like that.
Yeah.
But it again, like it, everything worked out fine. I just it's on me more than it is anybody else.
But
and,
it on Jen and Jay that they
yeah, but then Jay said they didn't see the light, right?
Yeah, here's
said
the thing:
there was no
is
light.
Anytime you do a new comedy club, you need to establish where the light
yeah.
is, and if because there's so much shuffling going on, and I don't show up until it's time for my set, so I wasn't there to remind them, hey, the light's right here. And Josh and Ken have never done the comedy club either
right.
before. So
we knew
you're doing a new venue, you get thrown in there, you're not sure where the light is. I totally
here's
understand
here's the nice thing,
that.
Though, is that in the back of the room, there was one of those digital clocks. It was red. We got on stage at 8:03. We got off at 8:18. So we did like a full 15-minute set. I know we didn't run the light by that much, but...
Is that what you were supposed to do?
15 minutes up top. Yeah.
No, yeah, you guys did 15 up top.
Yeah.
Was he supposed to, were they supposed to do 15?
They did some time in between.
Oh, okay.
Oh, it was the in-between stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, but so again, I want you... Here's the thing. It's
don't ever
if
change.
If somebody sucked on stage, then it's like, yeah, did you not see the
run.
Light? But everybody was murdering.
Yeah,
they
that,
were
that's,
crushing.
And that's what I said.
So it's a great show.
Yeah, that's what I said. I said it being in the audience that I could understand, you know, obviously, when you're up there and you're feeling the energy and you're going to... You're supposed to have 9 minutes and you do 15. You could,
nine?
I knew it was coming. And you could feel it, but you could also, Roxy was asking, well, how come that's not their fault? I was like, it is, but I kind of also understand.
It totally is, but it also, like, it made me happy because, again, like, going back to what I was saying before, is that I get to experience that feeling a lot because I'm on the road a lot and I get to see all these fans. It's like Josh and Ken are new to hosting on stage together still. Jay, Jen, these are people who've put in their dues on stage, and now for them to get the reward of everybody knowing who they are and getting excited to see them ahead of time, I think it's pretty cool.
Had you seen Jen before?
Yeah. Yeah, yes. Yeah, I've seen her. I think the first time I saw her was in the belly room of the Comedy Store. So she was making the rounds a lot, and then she took some time off. And
we
talked about it a couple weeks ago, and she said that she was starting to want to get back into stand-up. And I'm like,
well I bet you that show's going to definitely kick her back into gear, because she was good. Her timing was really good. I was impressed.
Awesome.
We lose you now, right? You're getting out of here?
Yeah, I got to go back to the gym.
All right, make sure you go check out if you buy those last 15 tickets, man. Go check it out at Mark Ellis
go
Live.
Go Patriots, right, Mark?
Is it Mark Ellis? Is Mark Ellis Comedy? Mark Ellis Live? I always forget.
Mark ElLisLive.com is where you can get tickets.
Get tickets.
I told Roxy I am not saying I'm rooting for the Patriots, but there's this weird tug.
I told
on
you,
my,
I told them your secret.
There's
that
this
you're a Patriots
weird
fan.
Tug that.
Why? How could you root against the LA?
I
with the Patriots.
Okay,
what?
First of all,
with
I don't care about an LA football team.
I don't care.
I don't care about LA
against
at
the
all.
Patriots though.
The only reason I don't want the Patriots to win is because the Steelers have six Super Bowls, and I'd like them to still have six, and nobody else have that many Super Bowls.
I guess it's just not the same thing. I just can't stand...
Something sucked me to the Patriots, and I don't know what it is.
Right, turn your mic off.
Something evil that Roxy implanted inside me. I can't fix it. I put it in your gum.
You put your gum in your drink, and then the Patriots came through.
I'm glad that we're losing you now.
Can I borrow a hair tie?
Yeah.
All right, listen. When we get back from the break, we are going to be talking about some news and nonsense, and Zack Snyder, he's coming back, ladies and gentlemen. The zombies will be happy to hear it. And then at 11:30, Benedict Wong will be joining us in studio to talk about Deadly Class. Pull out live. Hello there. No, it's not late to the party. That's actually from Obi-Wan Kenobi. You didn't know that? Well, you should, and now you do. Jedi Council. What is it? It's about Star Wars, obviously. It's Jedi Council. Every week, the latest and greatest in Star Wars movie news, myself and Ken Napsok, that's right, the pit boss himself, we have a guest on and we talk about everything happening in the world of Star Wars. If it's the movie news, the TV news, canon news, comic books, games, and then we take questions from you guys on Facebook and Twitter. It's a lot of fun. We've been doing it for a couple of years now. I'm still excited talking about it. The fan base is coming together again. I believe it is. I think it is. I hope it is. And we're talking Star Wars, so we'd like you. That's right, all of you. If you're not a fan of Star Wars, come on over and join us every Thursday for Collider Jedi Council here on Collider Video. And we have an Apple Podcast feed or Podcast One, wherever you want to go if you listen to podcasts. And not only do you get Collider Jedi Council every week on Thursday, The Rule of Two with Marc Fernandez and Mark Riley, that's on every week. I believe it drops on Wednesday. It's on one of these days. It's a good show. You should listen to it. I like it. I listen to it. I haven't listened to it once.
Hey, guys. Ryan Satin here from ProWrestlingSheet.com. And if you're a pro wrestling fan, which I hope you are, even if it's in secret, then you should be checking out Wrestling Sheet Radio Weekly. We've got a bunch of shows in the podcast feed. We've got weekly recaps from myself and John Rocha, which you guys will probably know from the Collider family. That's for Raw. That's for SmackDown. We've also got the weekly roundup of wrestling news. It's a show I host called Wrestling Sheet Radio with Jamie Iovine and Elijah Bates. And we've also got a bunch of other stuff in our YouTube channel, youtube.com/C/Wrestling Sheet. So check it out, subscribe, and I hope you guys dig it.
Hey, everyone. Mark Ellis here. You know, when I'm not trying to clone dinosaurs or drinking at my neighborhood watering hole, I am probably hosting Collider Movie Talk. It's a flagship show here at Collider. I like to say that because I'm the host of it. It's every day, almost. It's 4 days a week, which is still pretty good, above 50%. You can watch it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. 4 p.m. Los Angeles time is when we do it. It's live, so you can participate in the live chat room. Go ahead and give us your thoughts on every story we have coming because it's all the latest movie news of the day. Who did what at the box office? What horrible Redbox movies Bruce Willis signed on to? The DC, the Marvel, the Star Warses, the Lord of the Rings. Are they making new? I think it's a TV show, and we still might talk about it anyway because we love movies around here. It's myself and an expert panel of guests, including John Rocha, Perry Nemiroff, Jeff Snyder, and other noted noters of note. You guys are going to love this show, and then we take your live Twitter questions at the end of the show at Collider Video. You can always use the hashtag Collider Movie Talk to get in touch with us, so subscribe right here to Collider Video. Check out Movie Talk, and check out the Collider Movie Talk podcast feed. We have a podcast feed now. You don't have to look at this handsomeness. You can just listen to it, whether you're driving to work, whether you're driving from work, or you don't have a job, but you have a basement and ears. You can listen to Collider Movie Talks feed. You can get it at Apple Podcasts or on iTunes. You also get Mailbag. That's the show that's hosted by Perry Nemiroff a lot more professionally than I run this pirate ship. That's our weekend show where she takes your letters. I don't know if you write them or you email them. You have to ask her. Check it out in video form or on our podcast feed.
What's up, Collider fans? If you are a fan of television and you want to watch a guy that looks like me and a guy named Thad Williams talk about TV every single Friday, subscribe to the Collider channel. Collider Podcast is where you can find the video. We have our own iTunes feed, hashtag Collider TV Talk. You can find on iTunes or wherever you find your podcasts and you listen to them in your ear holes. That's where Collider TV Talk comes at you. We talk about TV news. We talk about shows we love, shows that we don't love. And most importantly, we don't read any books because TV has nothing to do with reading. We also have a show called Hypothetical Questions with myself and Roxy Stryer and all kinds of reviews right here at the Collider Podcast channel and the Collider TV Talk feed. Subscribe, rate, like, tell your friends, tell all your friends and tell their friends. And before you know know it, it's a pyramid scheme of television. I'm Josh McCuga. You can see Thad Williams and myself along with Roxy Stryer and all the Collider personalities all the time right here on Collider TV Talk. As always, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey everyone, I'm Scott Movie Manson. Just to let you know, if you already don't, every Friday here on Collider Video, I host a weekly film review series called Movie Review Talk. The title says it all. Every week, I'm joined by two guest critics of my choice, and they're never the same. We review the new films. We pick something that's streaming that you might not know about, but is really great. And we pick a Blu-ray for something that you might have missed in theaters. It is fun. It is infectious. It is the Citizen Kane of movie review shows, and it's only right here on Collider with this guy, Scott Movie Mance, Mr. Movie Release Dates himself. Check it out every Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific, only on Collider Video.
Collider Live, we are back. And Roxy, what were you just humming during the break?
I just watched the trailer.
Did you like the trailer?
Yeah, it's good, but I think that it was a little slower. I got to see. Yeah, I got to see what's going on. I'm still torn.
Is this Birds of Prey?
No, Lil Bobby and the Juice. All right, listen. So joining us today, we just made a really big announcement that Collider Live will be going 5 days a week. We just made a really big announcement that Collider Live will be going 5 days a week. Now, that couldn't have happened without the gentleman sitting in the room here. He is the owner of Collider. He is the guy, Mr. Marc Fernandez. Hello, Marc Fernandez.
Yo.
How are you doing? Nice to have you, dude.
What up?
How you doing?
What up?
What's so
you forgot host of Rule of Two.
And host of Rule of Two.
Is this
absolutely
your first time? I feel like no, one other time you were on.
Klitschko was on. Yeah, that's right. But
I wasn't here that one.
That didn't turn out the way I wanted it to.
It was a great, you
know? My questions clearly didn't turn out the way I wanted.
Klitschko almost punched him.
If you didn't watch the Klitschko interview, McCook asked him a question or something like that. He's like, I don't know. He asked him about getting punched in the face or getting knocked out.
I said, do you,
it was literally one of the tensest moments I've ever seen.
He looks over.
He goes,
I have very long reach. I could hit you from here. And you see McCook's face go. All right. I'm good. I think I'm going to leave that alone. I don't know if I told the story like right afterwards. Oh, so Fernandez, I've known Mark now for a while, and he's one of those guys that if he's got something on his mind and he makes it happen. So we had this VR Creed game.
Yeah.
And Fernandez was like, we got to get Klitschko to play it. So I see off the side, he's talking to Klitschko. I go, he's going to ask this motherfucker to do this.
Yeah.
And he says yes.
Yeah, he said yeah.
Were you nervous about that, or you just were like, I'm going
to
just
said, man, like, if you want us to promote this book, you got to come fight in VR. Yeah. He was like, all right, that sounds like a fair deal.
Yeah.
And but then
so he goes in there, and like he's got the things on, and I'm like, holy shit, and I got pictures of it, and this is going to happen. And it's 5 minutes, 10 minutes, they couldn't get it going, yeah. Right? The production. And they were trying hard. And it's something wasn't in the cards that day.
We'll need the real reason why it didn't work for behind the scenes.
But let's just say it wasn't in the cards. It just wasn't in the cards that day to happen.
No, it was in the cards, it just wasn't.
I'm trying to get you out of this.
Yeah.
anyway. But it just didn't happen.
I don't want to get out of it.
We'll talk about behind the scenes. But it just couldn't happen that day, right? So at one point he basically just like, we need to leave. And he's out the door. But it was a really fun.
It almost became a viral video.
It almost did. Yeah. Who knows? But
that would have been crazy.
Also, too, he wore a sweatpants suit. His suit was made out of sweatpants.
And it worked.
Yeah, because he's like a million bucks, champion too. Of the world.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Those are pretty popular these days, actually.
Interesting.
That dude is huge.
Yeah, he's probably got like, what, 3% body fat?
Oh, my God.
It's so crazy.
6'4", 6'5"?
I saw him afterwards because remember, I came for the tail end and watched you guys from the booth. I didn't think he was that big. You guys are all the same size to me.
He's 6'8".
Every single person in this room is the same size to me.
Yeah.
Like, when you're so small,
right.
you're all fucking huge.
Gandalf is huge.
You're all
Smeagol's
huge.
Yeah, right, I get it.
Like, I saw him, and I was like, yeah, he's big. But you guys were all like, whoa, wasn't he big?
He was
you guys were all the
I'm
same
six
size.
Feet. I was looking up. Like, I was looking at
he's
buildings.
He's like 41, 42,
he's,
right?
Yeah, he's 42.
Yeah,
42,
yeah.
He's our age.
Right. But, so listen. So
spoiler warning.
So that was the last time that you were on the show.
Yeah.
And so you decided to take this lunatic show that we have here instead of thinking that it was going to take us all off the air. We're extending it 5 days.
Yeah.
And you were the one, and to let everybody know, you were the one that came to me and said, I want to do Collider Live 5 days. Like, that meant a lot. So
how come?
Why?
I think it's mainly because of because of the listeners and the audience and the fans. I kept seeing on Wednesday people having a certain sense of dread that Thursday was coming up and that there was no Collider Live on Thursday. And then people on Friday saying, I wish there was Collider Live today. I saw enough of this out there and felt similarly myself to saying, you know what, like, the show's been going on now for what, 4 months, 5 months?
Yeah, but yeah, it started in like August, yeah.
And it's 3 days, and it's really got a really good morning radio vibe to it. And
you're blowing up.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Well, you're like that girl on the plane sitting next to me.
I thought it was my ears. That didn't even sound like a ring.
He was going nuts, yeah.
But then, like, you know, I was like, let's give them what they want. Let's see how it goes, you know, and hopefully we get more people invested in the show, bigger audience. You know, more engagement, more guests. More clip outs. Gives us 2 more days to have new guests,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And it gives us, you know, a chance to really see if we can build this into something even more special than what it is, you know? And it just, you know, Riley, are you okay with it or is it a lot more work for you?
Yeah, it's fine.
Riley's. Go ahead, Ryan.
No, it's more work, but it's good work.
Right.
It's going to be good because we have a lot. Just to everything you said, more guests can come on. We have a bigger window. We have more chances to clip stuff out, keep growing the channel.
The biggest bummer for now, anyway, is that we're losing Cobbster for a lot of it because editing.
Wait, what?
Sorry, Cobbster. Just let you know.
What happened? I was told I was going to host the show for Friday.
You're going to host the show on Friday.
That's what he meant by losing you. We're losing you.
Oh, that's right.
You in the booth. But Cobbster's one of the busiest editors that we have here, and so he'll be popping in as much as possible. Maybe we'll get him on that Friday show, but he'll be in when he's available.
Yeah. Look, and there's other changes coming down the pipeline, which I think are all good. Hopefully, Cobbster actually has been doing a lot more of these long-form videos. You know, he did an awesome job in picking up the mantle from Frank in editing the top 10 Star Wars heroes. And,
yep.
So he also did which of the top 10 did you do?
The top 10 series? I did the horror and
Wars heroes. Yeah, one. Horror. So hopefully we'll be doing more stuff like that.
Right.
Getting
Collider,
you know,
quick stuff. Yeah.
I mean, he's been crushing it on fake news.
What's the vibe on fake news on Collider Live?
People
in the comments below. Now, if you say fake news, does anybody know what you're talking about?
Not yet. I think it's done like 10,000 or 15,000.
It's a cult thing.
It's a cult thing. Yeah,
but I think two episodes.
more people need to go and watch it because I brought it up yesterday on the show on Collider Quick fake news. It's something, and I think that more people yesterday because we mentioned it yesterday. So I think that there were a couple more eyes on it.
Aquaman being there. No, Captain Marvel.
Captain Marvel's a sequel to Top Gun.
Yeah. So we had that, but anyway.
Is it?
Can't tell me
it's not
real news.
But the other big news is that Rule of Two this year moved on over to the main channel.
Yeah,
we have 2 Star Wars shows now, and you guys have been crushing it over there too. And I've told you this many times, off air, on air, that I believe that the reason why we're in this kind of new resurgence in Collider in general is because we've kind of switched to this more conversational style, and I think that's why Rule of Two is popping.
Yeah, I think, you know, we get a lot of comments, Riley and I have so much fun doing it with Riley. Even though he and I see Star Wars very differently, we also see it exactly the same way.
Wait, 2 people see Star Wars differently?
No way. Yes. And they're on the internet?
Yeah.
What?
But we also see it exactly the same way. And, I think the comment that we get that's the most common is, like, you know, people feel like they're just hanging out with their buddies talking about Star Wars.
Yeah, that's beauty of it, yeah.
We're not trying to throw too many errors because we obviously get canon wrong, like, every single episode, but... we're just having fun talking Star Wars.
And that's on what, Wednesdays, right?
Tuesdays.
Oh, it's Tuesdays now. No, you guys were taping
Tuesdays,
on Wednesdays.
Tuesdays, like, late night. It's like a late night show.
Right. It was on Wednesdays. on other channels.
I think we were, I forget where we were. It was over this weekend. It was, you and I were talking, and, like, Ken was there, and we were talking about Star Wars Celebration and all this stuff. And I was like, I feel like if it was just the Star Wars movies, I could probably compete in a Star Wars Schmoedown. And Chris was like, it is just the movies. And I was like, oh, then, yeah. Because I've been in part of them. I'm like, what book was that in? I don't know.
Yeah, and it's nothing to do with it. Yeah.
It's all the movies.
I mean, unless you want to stick around and talk, we have some news about Zack Snyder and some other stuff.
Look, I just wanted to say, go ahead.
Before you signed off, I'll let you sign off quick, but then I have a movie quiz for you that I want to do before you leave.
Oh, my goodness.
I want to see if you can get it.
I think he's going to.
You think he'll get it?
You think so? Oh, boy. I'm on the spot now.
But let's do your last thing you wanted to say, and then we'll.
Yeah, look, it just, I...
is this the last person we're going
to
do this?
You know, Godspeed is what I want to say.
Thanks,
you know,
buddy.
5 days a week, and hopefully it'll just build and build and build, and we can take the show and just keep growing it and keep doing cool stuff with it, And yeah, you know, it's like,
can I come?
Maybe some Collider Live remotes at local restaurants.
They already told me you were on the train. Is that not true?
Oh, I'm on the train. Yeah. I'm already coming.
Should be there. But thank you again. Thank you for believing in us. Thank you for understanding what the show was immediately when I told you to. For letting us do our thing. Like, that's the thing. I've said it on air, and I'll say it to you here too. You trusted me to run this thing, and you understood that that's the show. We're going to do some stuff. We'll talk about some stuff that might ruffle some feathers sometimes, but we're going to also have some fun doing it.
And
so
I said some provocative things, and you didn't kick me off. So no, I'm super appreciative.
Are you ready? You ready to take the sound clip? All right, this is from an 80s comedy.
Oh, God. Is this the goldfish thing again?
Oh, damn it. All right, forget it. You know about it.
I knew you'd know.
Goldfish thing. Yeah. Goldfish
thing. Damn it.
It's not a secret when you tell you everybody else.
But he wasn't around. He was catching snakes. I figured that he wasn't going to be there. He wasn't there.
All right, cool. Thank you, guys. Have fun.
Yeah, thank you.
See, he listens to the show. So that's how I can get it to. That's the quiz to see who listens to the show.
If you're not living under a rock, you know when a goldfish at this point.
We had a comment. By the way, we had a comment. I wanted to get his take on it, but he'll hear it. Bring back Captain Learning, you cowards.
Well, here's the thing with Captain Learning. Here's the thing with Captain Learning, and Cobbster will vouch for me on this one. I don't know if me is still in the room or Cody too, is that the thing with Captain Learning is we would love to bring back Captain Learning. We'd bring back Captain Learning tomorrow because Mark and I have been talking about it, Ken too, whatever. Yeah. Writing the things is not the impossible part. Writing is the easy part.
Yes.
The hard part is the edit. The edit is very, very difficult, and these guys are already slammed with edits. Fake News was our kind of answer to Captain Learning. Mm. It's a lot easier edit for Cobbster. It's a green screen. It's some great images. It's some funny jokes in there, and it is, you know, it's our kind of answer to Captain Learning.
How long is it?
Each one's about 4 to 5 minutes, you know, and we love Captain Learning. Unfortunately, for every one person saying bring back Captain Learning, you there was 4,000 thumbs down.
I wonder if it's such a different atmosphere now, though, too, because Collider was so differently back then when we dropped it on. When we dropped that, we had so many different type of material and programming that maybe more of the fans will understand kind of what we're, I don't know.
Again, we'd love to do Captain Learning. It's we just don't have the back end capacity.
We'll look into it.
We'll look into it. All right. Well, also, the other things I want to look into is the news here, because there's some stuff before we get into the fact that Zack Snyder is indeed returning. Anything else going on in the world of movie news?
I'm
going
to let Josh McCuga take the first news story here.
Oh my God!
Something
you're
that happened.
Really hard.
I'm trying to find it.
I'm like barely scratching.
I'm trying to.
What is it?
Okay, Will Smith.
Yes.
Posted a picture of him and Martin Lawrence in their full cop attire.
About this
I know, but you cut me off immediately.
Oh, okay, fine.
Classic Christian. Yeah. Always cutting my Bad Boys 2 stuff off. I get it. My Bad Boys for life. Like, yeah. Let's talk more about this fucking goldfish.
I'm going to stop you right there. Do you remember when I cut you off with?
Nah, I've got nothing.
You remember the fact that I said I'm trying to get you on the set?
The set?
That's true. You're right.
So did I catch you off with actual material? That
you did.
Right.
Yeah, you did.
So I made a little sorry there?
I'm sorry.
Still making up for Creed 2.
All right, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I'm still waiting on my Creed 2 screener at this point.
I'm canceling the Bad Boys trip.
All right. No, so he posted a picture.
No.
Nothing else then. We're back at it.
Well, it
moved a little. It was one of those like rotoscopes.
That's cool.
They both look awesome, ready to go. Bad Boys for Life.
You're ready.
Like a week in. My cousin
Cody, can you pull it up? I'm sorry.
Yeah. If we
sure.
can.
Apparently,
in the notes.
My cousin lives in the apartment building, and they're shooting right outside. He showed me a picture of Will Smith. I mean, guys, it's happening.
Your cousin took a picture of Will Smith?
Yeah. Wow. Not with him. He took a creepy Christian picture.
But he didn't post it on Instagram.
Yeah.
Good.
He didn't post it. I think he might have storied it. I'm not sure.
That's
maybe
good.
He put it on Snapchat. I don't know. He's younger.
There's the picture. There you go, right there.
Yeah.
They're ready.
Sick.
All right.
How sick is that?
This really is like your Star Wars, isn't it?
Yes.
It really is. Man. All right. Look. So there you go. You have that picture. That cat.
What's
that?
Up, girl?
Anything else? Or should we get into the Zack Snyder news?
Matt Reeves is talking about the Batman's going to be a true detective story. He's really deep into
That's what Batman is.
Yes, and that's what he said. He did a big interview with THR. He's like, nobody's really done Detective Batman.
And that's the essence of who Batman is, and we haven't done that yet. I think that's great. I think that's a new way to do Batman. Do you guys think that Matt Reeves' Batman, is this going to be the most authentic Batman movie?
Yes. And this, because following that up, there's going to be a rogue gallery. He's like looking at multiple villains.
Wow.
So I'm wondering what that is going
to
look like.
I don't think it's fair to call anything the most authentic thing when we've had decades and decades of Batman stories. Like, who's to say that one Batman story is more authentic than another? But
1989's first Batman with Michael Keaton is the most authentic Batman.
Well, you can say it's your favorite. You can say anything you want. Dude. But most authentic, I have a problem with.
Why?
But
True Detective Batman, from what it first came out, what made the character,
that's more authentic than other characters that we've seen since then. I don't think that makes any sense.
You're wrong. Like, to where when you start with the origins,
I don't agree with you, so it is a different
Eden. But it's a start of a character, the origins. What I'm telling you, exactly. What I'm telling you is that it is the most authentic to what Batman was in its essence when it came out.
I'm not saying that it's the most authentic to one particular Batman story, but there have been hundreds of Batman stories.
I'm talking about the authentic as far as the original character, what made Batman, Batman. That's the most authentic.
When you're eating Italian food, are you going to say that food that more resembles the north of Italy as opposed to south of Italy is more authentic? No, they're both authentic to Italy.
It's tomato sauce, it would be authentic for me.
Pretty good point. I mean, I like Roxy because I just got hungry.
I want pasta.
You take the Batman that you think is authentic. To me, what I'm saying is the authentic Batman that was created, the True Detective Batman, we haven't seen that before.
I agree with that, and I'm excited to see that. I agree that we haven't seen that.
That's what I mean. So that, to me, that's the most authentic to what we have seen.
The original Batman is what he's saying.
That's what I'm talking about. So you agree with that?
I agree with the original, yeah.
Yes, that's... All right.
So that's what Matt Reeves is
saying. But it's not your sole question was, is it the most authentic Batman?
To the original Batman. To the original of what when we first...
The spirit of what
Batman was. Who Batman was.
We got there.
Okay. So that's the main thing to me. So everybody thinks this could essentially be the most authentic to the original, what made Batman, Batman.
Yeah, and I think that would be exciting. I think that means that we're probably going along with the lines that we're going to have a younger Batman.
Right.
So when you're dream casting your head, think about that.
I don't think we need origins, though.
I think that if I see another pearl fall to the ground, I'm going to puke.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. Like, I agree.
Please don't.
Yeah.
Here's for me, and what I like about it is there's never been a point in a Batman movie where my favorite part is the fight scene. Right? Everything about Batman is always about like the noir, the building of the character, the detective work, the intelligence of the guy. And you know, like the coolness of it was never about the fight scenes. It was never
BBS,
about...
but that's not a Batman movie.
Correct. But I hated BBS. Right. Like, I wasn't a big BBS fan.
He certainly had elements in the movies, right? I mean, you had it from Michael Keaton's version, Christian Bale.
Yeah.
They all had that element of it, but I feel, you know, the ones that have gotten it the most authentic to that particular the detective side of it with the video games, like the Gotham or the Arkham Asylum. That to me has been the most authentic representation of Batman so far, and we haven't seen that in movies. So maybe Matt Reeves is gonna
do you guys have somebody you're picturing in your head that you think would nail it?
Give me an unknown.
I agree.
You want an unknown?
Give me an unknown.
It'd be great.
Give me an unknown. Give me an unknown because Batman himself sells the movie. But now, you know, do what they did in these other movies where Christopher Reeve was an unknown, right? But then they put Gene Hackman as Lex Luthor, who was a big star. But the difference is now, back then, you needed Gene Hackman's name because that was like the first superhero movie ever, right?
Yeah. And like you needed like a Kate Bosworth and a Kevin Spacey in that one with Christopher
Reeve. Yeah, but even then,
Brandon Routh.
Yes. Yeah, but even then, you didn't necessarily need them because I think, but today more so, the superhero movie sells itself. Batman is such a character now that Batman could sell the movie. You don't really need the big stars if the script's there and it works well.
I kind of tend to disagree with you on that one just a little bit because Christian Bale was like a megastar and then he steps into Batman and took that to a whole nother level. Ben Affleck, on the other hand,
Bale wasn't a big star at that time. Bale was not a big star when he took the role.
He was known, big enough, he was a big name at that time, but not like he is now.
He wasn't an unknown. He was in between.
Right. Yeah. He wasn't a movie star, but he was not a big name.
Give me somebody from like a great TV show that has seen, you know, some dramatic turns.
Do you not want a Gyllenhaal or a Jon Hamm or these are some of the names that have been tossed out there?
Gyllenhaal probably not now because of Spider-Man.
What?
Gyllenhaal probably not now because he's Spider-Man.
You know one of my favorite names that came out was Oscar Isaac. He just seems
Very interesting.
In my favorite movie of the year.
I still want younger.
Yeah, I'm wondering because that's the rumor, right? They're going to go young.
Do you want CW age? Like,
no.
So you want 30.
I think so.
You want 30 something.
Yeah, I think so. That gives me at least 10 years with this guy, you know, doing movies.
I mean, I know that I'm saying this because he's my friend, but it gets brought up a lot. It's either Wolverine or some version of a Dick Grayson Batman or Robin.
Yeah,
he
would be amazing.
It's Scott Eastwood.
Yeah, he would be awesome, but he's already in the DCEU.
Yeah,
that's right.
If this is part of that, unless this is like the Joker, and then he would be fine. Also, alternate timeline.
Reeves talked about that, the Aquaman, how different it was. From like Batman v Superman, so he was kind of hinting that this could be a little like in the own universe of Batman, you'll get Batman and not necessarily like completely beholden to connecting to the broader DCEU.
Right. Yeah, I think it will start to get very confusing for general audiences.
Yeah,
though.
I did too.
It's just they're on a slippery slope right now with having two Jokers in the same.
I don't disagree.
It's interesting, and I do like the comments though by Matt Reeves. So we'll see what we're in store for. But let's get to the main story here. Zack Snyder is back. He's been sitting out for a little bit, taking his time, obviously, and as he should have, and now he comes back and he's going back to his roots.
Going back to his roots, and it's for Netflix.
What do we got? Something
$90 million budget for a zombie apocalypse kind of action movie, but it's like Ocean's 11 meets like Dawn of the Dead.
Cool.
And so some guys, they try to pull off a heist in Vegas during a zombie apocalypse. So they're going to go through. Yeah. And Zach is saying no one's ever let me completely loose. So he had the idea and he wrote it with somebody and he's just going to go all in and do whatever he wants with
this. I think this is cool too because I've been talking for a long time. We need the next level of these movies, the vampire movies, the zombie movies, all of those movies that are the same and about being a zombie. Like what about that's the world you're living in?
Right.
What's happening in that world? So I think that it's cool that they're like bringing in a different genre and not just making this a zombie film.
And he needs to do stuff like this too. I think that the other thing for him is when you go back, Dawn of the Dead was the one that he did, right?
Yeah,
that
was his first. I remember
when he hit with that, and I was working at Village Roadshow at the time, and then everybody was talking about the movie, about this new hot director was coming out, and you could tell his style. And it was one of those things where he was able to do what he does. I think once you get too locked into the superhero genre, and when you have this big property like DC, which is trying to find its mark, it's like it's overwhelming. He did very well for them, made a lot of money for the company, but I think now it's time for him to go back and do what he wants to do. I'm excited for it. I think that I'd rather see him do these types of movies, and I know he knows how to do zombies.
I mean, you know it's going to look cool at the very least. Cool.
Right. So I'm down for it. I think this is a good move for him. I think this could be something that's really entertaining.
This is one of the bigger directors that Netflix has landed to as far in this genre, you know what I mean?
Very true.
Netflix is crushing.
I mean, 90 mil, that's nothing to laugh at. Like, 90
million?
That's a massive budget for them to put on a movie for a Netflix movie.
Right.
And you think you got Michael Bay now doing Netflix movies. You got Zack Snyder now, Martin Scorsese. Adam Sandler has been
What the studios
the
are
next
saying,
level kind
and of. What the old is that Netflix is it doesn't have the old studio model of like let's get 30 people's opinion on this one script and then it turns into an absolute disaster.
Do your thing, basically.
Go, here's your money. Right. Go nuts.
Right. It seems like that's what they really are focusing on. It's like, oh, you want it? Like Snyder saying, I'm going to be let loose. They're like, here you go. But here's $90 million. What does that look like?
You know what's funny though? What they're doing, which is funny because I have the actual opposite opinion that these people should be doing it. Lucasfilm is doing that. And so is Netflix. And I think it works for Netflix. I think the Lucasfilm should have a little bit more of a narrative to pertain to.
I
applaud them and I applaud Kathleen Kennedy for saying I'm going to trust in this director to do this, but I think there needs to be a little bit more bobbing and weaving through the narrative.
I agree.
Netflix doesn't need to do that.
But think about, I don't know if I think Netflix doesn't need to. I think what Netflix is smart about is knowing when they need to. For example, when we had Sarah come and sit here and talk
Sarah
about.
Sarah Campbell, yeah.
Yeah, and she was talking about with you, you know, we were all saying, isn't it great that they're so hands-off? And she was like, they're paying millions of dollars. I mean, I guess relatively hands off, but they're still giving their input.
Right.
And for somebody, for a show that's more unproven, for showrunners that are less proven than a Zack Snyder, I think it's good that they're starting to be like, all right, Let's.
Oh, wait. I want to make it clear. I think that if you're spending that much money, you should absolutely be hands-on. That's right. Not what I'm saying. What I was talking about as far as Lucasfilm goes is that Kathleen Kennedy is very hands-on. There's no doubt about that. Mm-hmm. I'm just talking about how when you have a previous movie and there's other stories that you want to be able to do much collaboration or have a plan from A to Z. You know,
yeah,
I know exactly what's going to happen. But it seems like J.J. Abrams is going to pull that back and do that now. But Netflix doesn't have to have, they don't have any connective tissue, right? But I do agree with you. You got to be hands-on if you're spending that much money.
Yeah. I'd love to see some sort of, in the future, like a Netflix franchise universe.
Right.
Something like
that'd
an IP.
That'd be so cool.
They're doing that. Mark Millar, who has a number of comic books, they're calling it the Millar universe, and they've made a deal with him. So I think that's their next big thing.
But is it, are they original stories, or you're saying
it's
they're
his comics.
Adapting
his comics. Well, and then creating that kind of universe through Netflix.
Well, the next big thing, I think, is in the lobby.
Yes,
I think Benedict Wong is here. We are going to talk to him after the break, guys. He's here to talk about Deadly Class. Benedict Wong, Doctor Strange, he's going to be in here after the break, Collider Live. Hello, Collider fans. I'm Christian Harloff, and you see my stupid name in the background because that's my other show. It's One-on-One with me, Christian Harloff. What the hell is it? I just sit down and talk to people. I literally just sit down and talk to people about what the hell's going on in their lives and their careers, and it's a long-form interview show. Originally, it aired on Collider Video as far as the YouTube channel goes, but we moved it on over, and it's on the Collider Podcast, on YouTube. Go on over there if you want to see the video and to see the pretty faces that I'm talking to. Had some great guests over the past. And we're going to have a lot more. And there's going to be people that maybe some celebrities or actors and actresses, producers, writers, all that stuff. But there's also a lot of the people that you know around here. I could have Cobbster on there. I could have Jeff Snyder, John Rocha, Mark Riley, Roxy Stryer, whoever. And I'm going to find out more about them. Long form, and also go to Apple Podcasts and check out the One-on-One feed with Christian Harloff. And not only is my show on there, Mark Riley, the Riley Roundtable, which is another sit-down, long-form interview show, that's also there. And when Steve Frosty Weintraub talks to Kevin Smith or George Takei, that's going to be on that podcast feed also. So if you're taking a long drive and you like those long-form interviews, pop on the One-on-One with Christian Harloff. Give it a rate, comment, do all that because it helps the show and it makes Podcast One go, hey, you know what? Those people should get ad money.
Oh, hi, guys. It's Perry here, and I am going to tell you about The Witching Hour. It is the show that I host along with Collider.com's Haley Fouch. It is in podcast form on the Collider Factory feed, and we also have the video up and running every Tuesday for you right there on the Collider Podcast YouTube channel. We talk about everything horror. We're talking TV, movies, the newest releases. We talk about movies that are celebrating anniversaries. We've even talked about books. It's crazy. If it is scary, we are talking about it on The Witching Hour. We also have so many filmmaker interviews, really cool stuff. It's all coming your way every single Tuesday on The Witching Hour. Check it out. Collider Factory and the Collider Podcast YouTube channel.
Hello, Collider Live. My name is Amy Dallin.
And I'm Corey Jandro, and we host a little show we love called Collider Heroes. And it is all of the things we love about movies, TV, comics themselves, all the breaking news, trailers, photos, but not paparazzi photos.
All of the superhero stuff we love, all of the indie comic stuff we love, all the stuff you had no idea was based on comics.
80 years of comic lore have led to this show and many years in film and TV, and we're living in a golden age of comics, and we want to share all of that zeal with you folks.
So we talk about the stuff that's coming out. We talk about what we hope is coming out. We do fantasy casting of things that should exist. Why don't they exist?
And we do your Twitter questions asking directly to us what we think of certain things. And every single week, since we both actually love and read physical comics by in print, we have a comic pull list where our five biggest favorite books of the week come out, and we dive into those with you guys.
You can buy digital. I'll forgive you. As long as you're paying for your comics, it's all good.
But if you buy in print, you can bag them and board them, and then they're worth more later, because comics are like certain things from the 90s that are totally worth the value. Buy comics. Buy in print. Digital's never worth anything later. Buy in print. Keep comic stores alive.
Or we can debate collector's items all day long. We can debate casting. We can debate movie news. We can have all of our friends come join us, as we frequently do. We can ask professionals about their work. We've had some amazing guests come by the show.
Yep. We try to
catch it every Wednesday.
That are on these properties that also love comics. You hear what it's like from their perspective, from inside, from outside. And this is all with the focus of bringing all this news to you guys. And we're here every Wednesday on Collider. And we love this stuff and want to share it with you guys.
We'll see you then.
Hey guys, Riley here, and let me tell you about the Riley Roundtable. That's right, they gave Riley his own podcast. The Riley Roundtable is on its new home, and that is one-on-one with Christian Harloff on the iTunes feed for Podcast One. It drops every Thursday. The Riley Roundtable is a little bit about everything. It's about movies and life, life and movies and everything in between. I like to have on special guests for discussions like Justice League versus Batman v Superman, for discussions about wine tasting, for discussions about UFOs, and everything in between. That's right. The Riley Roundtable drops on Thursdays on the One-on-One with Christian Harloff podcast feed and later on Collider Video's own podcast video network. So check it out every Thursday, the Riley Roundtable. See you there.
Hey, everyone. This is John Rocha. You know me as one of the co-hosts for Collider Sports Time every Monday on Collider Sports YouTube and podcast channel. But we got another show on here. That's Collider Sportsbook. Josh McCougar, the Wild Man, he hosts that one. I join him on those, and they're a lot of fun. We break down the lines and the predictions with the over and unders. A lot of stuff going on for all the NFL games and some select college football games as well. We do that every week. We also do special ones on Thursday nights for those Thursday night football games. Let you know where to put your money, what bets to put down, who to go with, who not to go with. We give you a lot of information and we give you our thoughts. You know, Josh McCouga, he does it by the gut. I do it more from the statistics point of view. And every once in a while, Marc Fernandez even joins us to throw in his two cents on the Thursday night sports book. So there's a lot of sports action here on Sports Time, on the Collider Sports YouTube and podcast channel. Join us there. Subscribe there. Definitely on the podcast channel. We need your downloads, subscriptions, and views there. So give us some love on Collider Sports, and we'll talk to you soon.
We're back. It is Wednesday's last show this week, but again, once again, you guys know we're going 5 days a week next week, Collider Live. But
boom.
Enough about us. I'm sick of talking about us.
5 days a week. Five days a week. Collider.
That's right. Listen, joining us in studio from the show Deadly Class, which airs Wednesdays at 10, 9 central on Syfy, the one, the only, Benedict Wong. Hello, Benedict. How are you doing, man?
Very good, thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you in here.
Thanks for having me in this little snug room. Yeah. I might take my jacket off later, but I'll maintain the look
for, now, yeah.
For radio.
That look is sharp.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, you're on right now.
Oh, too. Yeah. And also for the views. Hey,
well, he's British. He had to wear a jacket. He had to wear a suit and jacket with a pocket square.
I bet you guys miss wearing coats. Well, I mean, occasionally you do, don't you?
Yeah, we did a lot of coat wearing. We just went to New York. So we were just in New York wearing a lot of coats. And nice. I'm done with the coats right now.
Put your puffer on.
Yeah. So listen, man, let's talk about your show. I'm going to talk about Deadly Class here. That's why you're here, too. And Roxy and Roker. They had a chance to, you were raving about it. So
yeah, such a good show.
Thank you, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a fantastic. I mean, taking that property and turning it into a TV series with and still keeping the hardness and the brutality of that story was incredible. What Syfy let you guys get away with.
Absolutely.
And your portrayal of Master Lin is very tone perfect in terms of the material, but then you put your own interesting spin on that thing.
Yeah, bless you. Thanks. Well, I mean, you know, we've been really lucky that obviously, you know, Syfy and Agbo and NBC, they've all kind of just given the reins back to Rick Remender and Wes Craig, and you know, just to do the transition from comic and to do it justice, and also just to elaborate further into that world. You know, I think definitely people that have invested in the comic will, you know, we'll be very pleased. You know.
For anybody who's watched the pilot, you'll know that the first 2 minutes of it are very intense. Something happens from your character where I was taken aback. Like, I had no idea where the show was going. Did you know that that was going to be the first thing the audience saw? Because then, of course, we flash backwards to the day before.
Yeah. When I read the script. But, I mean, I think it really kind of, you know, there's a real sort of stamp of authority about what Master Lin expects, and you know, it kind of, I mean, people that haven't seen it, you know, it's kind of slightly conflicting, you know, because he's whacking a cane in a girl's face,
and she's gushing blood. Christian, like, this girl gets hit and she's like
teenager, right. And he smacks her so hard. It was very jarring in a good way, though. That's obviously the impact.
I think that's the starting point of the world that we're in now. So, like, in a way, we're not messing about.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm just looking over just a lot of the stuff that you've done. And the first, so Prometheus, obviously, and working and then jumping from Kick-Ass 2, The Martian, and obviously Doctor Strange being the big one. The really big one that I was like, well, that's where I really noticed you. And I said, who is this guy? You kick ass in that movie. But what you do, it's the subtlety of that role, but it's also how intense the role is and what you bring to your roles in general. But noticing that now you've got this show, that which combined from the comic book, Doctor Strange, do you find yourself kind of gravitating towards that type of material, or it's just about whatever the material is that's good?
That's it. You know, I've got a little special dowling stick for, you know, kind of projects that I kind of go for. Yeah. You just feel it in your gut, really, doesn't it? I mean, I'm lucky to, you know, I mean, I've been doing it now for 28 years, and, you know, you sort of job around as an actor and... And then, you know, if you're fortunate to be, you know, involved in projects that kind of, I mean, with the Russo brothers behind us as well. And, it was the material that was, I don't feel, has been done before as well. Mm-hmm. I'm just kind of bang into it.
Well, I want to hit you with that with the Russo brothers, because when you get because obviously with the success of Infinity War and now here comes Endgame around the corner. I don't know if you're we don't know if you survived or not, right? Because they don't show you disappear.
I don't want to get you in trouble. Do you know the answer?
I just got
that?
A buzz from the pro. I'm wearing.
That was Joe and Anthony. That was Joe and Anthony. Don't you say a word.
If you're not allowed to answer, Let it be, man.
Poor Jimmy. Sorry, Jimmy.
He'll be okay.
Stan's looking at me as well. I mean,
Stan's good to go.
I mean, hey, what can I say? I did post a picture on the little Instagram thing where I was toing and froing from Deadly Class and to it was just great that the Russo brothers were involved, and it was an easier transition about negotiating about hair and stuff.
Did you know you were the one character when you got onto Doctor Strange? Did you know the one that was going to transfer over into the Avengers movies? Did you know that it was going to be like when they pitched it to you, the character of Wong? Did you know? Because like you stand out so distinctly in that movie, and there are a lot of great actors in that movie. Way you play that role is so fun and interesting, juxtaposed with how Benedict Cumberbatch is doing his thing. Did you know, or was it because you the fans responded so well to move you into that?
When I first got the gig, I mean, I first got the gig via, Chiwetel's Ejiofor's a good mate of mine. And so we were doing The Martian together. Yeah. And then, you know, you're just chatting around and saying, hey, what are you doing next? I'm doing Doctor Strange. So, you know, having a look online. And then all of a sudden, I just saw this picture of Strange and Wong. Mm-hmm. And I just couldn't believe it, you know. And this was it. I was going, I have to get this for the ancestors, you know, alone. You know?
Right.
And then
knock down the wall, get in the room, and then
They came to me while I was filming Marco Polo, and then I went on tape in Budapest, and I've never when you really really want something, and I was just in the room for 8 hours trying to get the dialogue right. I mean, one of the lines is the sanctum relix, and I kept saying the rectum salix, just getting so nervous. Anyway, by the time we were in Slovakia, there was a few more tweaks, and then by the time I was in Malaysia, they said, you know, you've got the gig.
Wow.
As soon as I got onto the material, though, it was the 60s, and a different take, really, on what that character was, and I was definitely... adamant in wanting to put a different spin on that. And I remember being in the trailer, and Kevin Feige and Stephen, one of the producers, you know, I just said, look, I'm not really into this tea serving bollocks, you know. I was like, no, neither are we. So I was like, great, good. And so, like, you know, like, as you said, it makes a good foil to kind of Strange's arrogance. Mm. Really, yeah. And this kind of no nonsense.
Well, yeah, and it was all of that. And like I had mentioned earlier, it's how subtle it is. And it just, you can still have a big impact. And I think you did the same thing in Infinity War. It's like the character can kick ass, but it's the subtlety of the role.
Yeah.
But like you said with the transition of Doctor Strange now, because the thing is, I guess because when you're with Marvel at this point, you can hope that it's going to be a hit. You think that it will because everything else is hitting. But there's got to be that maybe that doubt of will people respond to Doctor Strange? I know the comic book fans love it.
Yeah.
But are people going to love this? Is this because I think that everybody maybe is like, oh, I don't want this to be the one that doesn't work because all their movies work. So does that ever go through your head or you knew that this thing was going to hit just from the way it was working?
No, do you know what? You never know. You never know. All you got to do is just throw in everything at it and throw your best in it, you know, and walk away feeling satisfied that you've done everything that you can, and then it's up in the ether. I mean, I've always had that with everything, you know, even with Deadly Cast, any job that I've done, you know.
And you make that connection with the Russo brothers to where you get, and then how does this get brought up to you then? With Deadly Class, how does that happen? Like in regards to, do you get the same thing sent the script? Know that this is something you had said that you responded to the material, but like, at what point? Where are you when you're approached with this show?
I just got a call off Joe really, and out of the blue, and.
For an audition, or it was a straight offer?
Straight offer. Wow.
Congratulations.
Yeah. No, thank you. And, you just say yes straight away, really. I mean, the guys have got such an...
Right.
What wouldn't you want to do a project with
great
with them,
dudes,
you know?
Too, man.
They're wonderful guys.
Yeah, Uber fans.
Were you concerned, though, about Marvel at all being upset with you working on another comic book franchise or property, or that was not...
No, not at all. And I'm sure they're not. I mean... I just work from project to project.
If it's not in the contract, do it.
Yeah. Hey, I'm not tied to anybody.
Well, and the Russos work on both the Deadly Class and Avengers, so it's easier to transition. Yeah.
It's more on them than me.
Yeah. Right.
Are there other projects that they've talked about that you've talked about with them? Because look, we live in an age. You look at Damien Chazelle, who works with Ryan Gosling all the time, or Scorsese with DiCaprio, and now you're starting to work a lot with the Russos, and those are good people to be in with right now. You know. Like they got you in both these big movies here too, and Derrickson too. I mean, and so you have all this, you have these connections now. I feel like the Russo brothers are going to do a Star Wars movie. I just feel like, or something along the lines. I know they're Star Wars fans. I had them in here talking about Star Wars. Are you a Star Wars guy?
I am a Star Wars guy.
Yeah,
and I'm a good pal of Michael Giacchino.
Yeah,
and,
we were talking about him yesterday.
He's a lovely guy, and. So he asked me to do a little bit in his short film, and it was at so I drove up and it was at Bad Robot.
Mm.
So I turned up at Bad Robot and I was like, oh my god, this is amazing. Yeah. You know, I mean, even like in the Collider studio, I'm just looking at all your bits on your desk and everyone's like memorabilia. And so we were just I was doing a scene and then JJ turned up. I was like, oh, yeah, bloody hell, and he just so tempted to mention the S word, you know. It's like, how are you doing? And then there was I saw him twice actually, but I mean, I would have loved, I mean, maybe further down the line.
Did you talk to JJ? Did you get to communicate with him?
Yeah. And
what's the conversation with JJ like? This first time you're meeting with him, and he knows who you are, and you just have a conversation. Like, what's the conversation like on that day?
Well, I also met him for Michael's 50th, which was on at the Royal Albert Hall, where he, all the music that he did were lost, and so there was like Carlton Cuse and who were all the directors of all the movies?
Yeah,
so, like,
yeah.
Everybody was all there. We were all in a lift together. It was kind of like, just all just handing out my CVs to everybody, you know. But it was great. You That's know, cool. He's a really cool guy.
It must be crazy, right? Because you're from a small town in England, and you're Salford, here I am, Salford, and here you are in an elevator with all these incredible people. And I think I read like you used to work carrying the potatoes and all this kind of like going from something like that, going from a life in there to this moment in the elevator must have been just crazy for you.
Yeah, everything has become quite surreal for me. You know. You know, but I just think, I just really wanted to be an actor. And, I literally started from sweeping the floors and collecting tickets in a fringe venue in Manchester. And, And Steve in the lighting box would circle all of the great touring shows that would arrive. And you watch stuff, you absorb it, and you know, and then I was just kind of doing anything and everything. You know, I started from every single rung of the ladder, and I always say I'm an actor in progress, and that's it.
But isn't that the thing though? Isn't it the thing, because obviously you need the talent, and you have that talent. But isn't it the drive itself? Isn't it the thing that you have to look, because there are a lot of people out there with a lot of talent that don't have the drive and don't have that to sit there and say, okay, I'm not going to be doing this forever. I'm not going to be doing this job that right now, you know, it's important because I need to make money, but it's not who I am. Yeah. How do you get past the doubt? How do you get past the opportunities that may not be there? And look at you now. I mean, what you're doing, this is a story that a lot of people out there should be like, this is a big story.
Dream big and just kind of, you know you've got to make steps to get there, and that is it. And, you know, I mean, I've done bar jobs and you know, there's loads of, you know, I've done pretty much every single job in acting, really, and played roles. I didn't really want to play, but, you know, you kind of just... it'll pay the rents as well, and you survive as an actor as well. Not at all. And you know, it's in all jobs that we're doing, and just keep your dream alive. And you know, it's just either acceptance or change. You know, if you're not happy in the job that you're in, move on somewhere else. Fundamentally, just take care of your well-being. You know, yeah. I mean, and it's a tough job as well in the acting game as well, where people, you know, you're waiting on a job and stuff. But again, like, there was something that I saw that Bryan Cranston said, and it was amazing, isn't it? You just kind of go in there, you do your audition, and you do the best you can, and then you walk away, and you don't think about anything. Get on with your life.
Right.
And that is it, you know, and just create, write.
In the 28 years, because you said that's how long you've been at it, which is amazing. When did you feel the snowball start to pick up?
I never really went to drama school, and as I said, I mean, it was just by the kindness of, you know, a lot of people in Manchester where, I always remember Judith, who was the house manager of the Library Theatre, would just sneak me into the theatre, and I'd watch 4 hours of Galileo, you know. there were a few breaks in my life, you know, where... Tim Bigot-Smith, who an actor who has sadly passed away, but people that take you under your wing and, you know, kind of give you that kind of sort of tutelage, you know, and then you kind of get some reviews from the broadsheets and you collect them together, and then you try and step up again. I didn't have a London agent. I moved on to a London agent. You know, they get you certain types of roles, but you're just kind of sort of wanting to keep pushing forward, and sometimes you kind of have to be bold enough to kind of close the doors on the ones that you don't want to do that you have done. Yeah. And
that's got to be scary, though, too.
Yeah. But, I mean, once you make that decision, other than that, you just enter into this world of kind of a repetition, really, you know.
Well, that's a confidence, too, isn't it? Because it's one of those things to where you have to, like, I think that's why I asked you before, like, do you know, and I'm not saying from a place of, like, cockiness or arrogance, but a place of just extreme confidence. Do you see when you're struggling? Do you see yourself going, I'm going to hit that spot. I'm going to get there. And because there's a lot of things going on in my life right now that I'm looking and I'm saying, I got to get there. There are these doubts. There are these things that I have to overcome, but I'll get there. Does that go through? Do you ever think about, I'm not going to do this anymore. I'm just going to focus on something else. Or do you just, there's never a stop. You just ran to the hill.
No, hey, I mean, there were a number of occasions where I nearly gave up, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, one instance in particular where I moved from Manchester because I couldn't get a job in Manchester, and moved to London, then had to actually go back up to Manchester for what was really an illegal immigrant, and one line in the back of a van in a comedy. It was a funny comedy. And I waited there for about an hour and 40 minutes. No one came out. And I was just pissed off. I just went, you know what? I wrote this letter to that casting director and went, hey, I love the show, la, la, la. Wish you all the best. But, you know, I'm better than this. But... yeah, I don't know if you wrote that down, whether or not you read it in a different way, you know. But like, yeah, but I mean, I was really kind of on a heartfelt, made sure the girl on the reception handed it to her, and then called the agent, said, that's it, I'm done. And I was literally done. And then he said, no, I've got this other script for you. He said, what is it? He said, it's an illegal immigrant. I'm like, fuck.
He's got two lines.
And then, but that happened to be Dirty Pretty Things.
Oh, right.
Which was with Chiwetel Ejiofor.
Yep, that's where you guys met each other. Oh, yeah, look at that.
And with Stephen Frears and Stephen Knight had written it, Peaky Blinders. Mm. And again, that was almost like a...
And that was your life. You were done.
Life raft again. Wow. Like,
look at that.
And you know, just like tears in my eyes, reading actually a role.
Yeah.
And that's all you want to do. You know, you want to be. You know, and I speak out for all actors of color. You know, we just want to be actors playing human beings who happen to be of color.
Right.
And that is it. And that's the struggle. What's going on? You know.
Yeah.
You know, you're trying to kind of acting is about relaying the truth, and then sometimes you're just boxed into various different, you know, stereotypes.
But that was great, though. I mean, so you wrote the letter to the cast and said, and not in a cocky way. Just like, I know I have more in me than just this.
Yes.
And you're about to give up. You're about to quit. You get this call. You get this. This is literally seems to be the one that changed your life, because look at all these relationships you make. You meet Ejiofor there, which eventually gets you in the room with other potential opportunities. And now we've got Deadly Class once again on Wednesdays, 10 o'clock on Syfy. And you just keep going. It's good stuff. So what should the fans know about this show, though? Because I want to for those fans, reasons why, because obviously they're fans of you. They know what's going on with Doctor Strange and the Avengers. Why do they need to watch Deadly Class, besides the fact that you're in and the Russo brothers have something to do with it?
You know what? It's just this. It's for me, I'm just hanging on to the coattails of this incredible ensemble of young actors. They're amazing. I mean, you know, Benjamin Wadsworth, you know, Maria de Gabriella, Friet, Lana Condor, Siobhan Williams, Jack Gaylor, Sean Deppner, Liam James, Tom Stevens. I have to mention them all, Taylor Hicks. Yeah.
There's one person that you missed that's pissed right now.
Oh, no, I haven't. Have I? Oh, my God, I haven't.
No, like, you're good.
Do you know what? They're really one. They're all going to have burgeoning careers, I think.
Good.
I mean, I think the casting has been fantastic.
Do you have other things that you want to do? Comedy-wise stuff? Do you want to do, because I mean, we know, obviously, you have the comedy chops. Do you want to do more comedy? Do you want to do, is there anything that you, any directors that you want to work with that you haven't worked with? Like, because like you said, you walked in, you talked to JJ and have that great conversation. Are there other people out there? You're like, oh man, I'd love to do a Scorsese film. I'd love to, those are easy ones, obviously. But like anything along those lines?
Yeah, just a lot of the kind of all those amazing Mexican directors and all the Danish directors.
Right.
And, I mean, I'd like to get some of my own projects off on the ground now, really. And
you're producing as well. You're doing.
I'm not producing as such. I just want to kind of get my own and start writing.
Great. Some projects. So that's what you want to do as well too. What kind of stuff are you looking to do?
Well, I've kind of sort of got three in my head.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which I sort of. Just these little legs that I sit on.
Yeah. And it's things that you want to eventually do, and be able to, you just got to find the time for it, right?
Yeah.
Now. Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. Listen, thank you. Go ahead, Roxy.
It's sticking with me what you said about all people of color wanting to be known as amazing actors who happen to be people of color. And I was wondering how you feel like Hollywood's handling that in 2019, and if it is getting better or if it's kind of just staying the same.
Well, you know what? I think it's. You're a damn sight. It's a lot better here than it is in England. Mm. You know,
really?
I think you're kind of sort of 10 years ahead.
Wow. We'd never heard 10 years ago. Well, 10 years ago we wouldn't have heard anything like that.
Yeah.
Definitely. But I mean, but that is it though. I mean, I think it's quite a rarity really to. I'm one of the fortunate few, you know. I mean, there's a lot of East Asian, talented East Asian actors in England that, you know, deserve to be literally seen for stuff, you know. It's just this identity of what is British, what is American, you know what I mean? It's
well, you like see that happening.
From everywhere, you know.
You see that happening in sports and in the
arts all the time. You know, my girlfriend's a massive fan of British television. Most everything is full of Caucasian actors, white actors. Yeah. It's the rare person that comes in and does The Immigrant for one line or something like that. But you see in the superhero genre, that's definitely not true. It's changing. Even with Deadly Class, a multiracial show like this, if you're in charge of them, there must be a certain sense of pride for you in that you're like the headmaster of this school, this multiracial cast. It's fun to kind of be a part of this.
Absolutely, right? Absolutely. And they're just playing characters themselves, you know. Yeah. I mean, the action scenes are fantastic, you know, like kind of the Russo brothers go over with a fine comb and then kind of like, you know, put their lovely little stamp on that. And what Rick's written and Miles, they're great guys to work with. I mean, the crew in Canada, wonderful, lovely people. I mean, we've had a lot of fun.
It's been a lot of fun having you in studio, man.
Oh, bless you, man.
Thank you for being in here.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Deadly Class airing Wednesday. Sci-fi, don't forget about Endgame. That comes out the end of April. We're going to guess that he's in it. He's not going to tell.
Yeah. And also, you know, support Image Comics as well, you know.
Yeah,
I mean, I think Marvel are doing pretty all right.
They're doing pretty well,
those guys. So Image Comics as well, and go back to the source material as well. I mean, and then come enjoy the ride that will take you on.
Absolutely. And you also see Benedict on, he's going to be on Collider Heroes as well. So make sure you check out their episode over there. I mean, so much fun to have you
Thanks,
in here,
man.
My man. Thank
Appreciate
you. Please
it.
Come back and see us again. Please. Love to have you. All right, guys. So that's it. Collider Live. We are done for this week. But once again, next week, Monday through Friday, Collider Live, you're going to not be able to get rid of us. Win a goldfish, Ann.
Collider Live.